January 9th, 2017 school committee meeting to order. We'll start with public comment for those of you who maybe haven't been here before. Public comment is an opportunity to approach the microphone and address the school committee on any item that is not on the agenda. So if you came to talk about something that is not on the agenda, that would be the time to do that. We have a quick and very wonderful donation to approve. We'll go through reports, and the bulk of our meeting tonight will be focused. It's the first meeting we're going to have on the FY18 budget. Tonight, Dr. Doherty will be presenting an overview along with the administrative and regular day cost centers. Before we get to all of that, I wanted to make a couple of brief announcements. First of all, generally speaking, at school committee meetings, the committee deliberates and asks questions before going to the public. I was mortified last week when a member of the public came up to me after the meeting and said she had tried to get my attention and I didn't see her. So I've apologized to her, but in the event that you have something to say during the meeting and I'm not seeing you, please get my attention. If you have to stand a little or wave a little bit, please make sure you get my attention. So I apologize that that happened, but we do absolutely want the public's input here tonight and for the next few weeks. I wanted to talk briefly about the budget process so far. This is the first night the school committee is meeting on the budget, but that doesn't mean this is the first night of the budget. Dr. Doherty and his staff, he'll talk about this a bit in his presentation, I think, have spent the last several months developing this budget. So he can talk about the process from his end. I did want to talk briefly about the process from our end. Tonight we will go over an overview of the overall FY18 proposed superintendent's budget and talk about two cost centers, administration and regular day. On Thursday, we'll meet to talk about the special education cost center, district-wide services as well. We do not meet on Monday because it's Martin Luther King Day. Thursday, January 19th, we will have a public hearing. That's an opportunity for anyone who wants to come in and say something about the budget to come in and share their thoughts on it with us. We'll also look at town and school facilities. At that point, we'll also address school committee questions. We may ask factual questions as Dr. Doherty and Ms. Dowd go through their presentation, but we all, as school committee members, keep detailed lists of questions, and there are so many of them, and they're so rich that it can derail meetings. So the process we've developed is we submit our questions in writing so that they can do the research, and they actually submit their answers in writing and they become part of the school committee budget so anyone can see the questions that we've asked and the answers that were provided. So as they're talking, they see us making notes, we're jotting down further inquiry for the future. So on Thursday the 19th, after the public hearing, we will begin discussion of the questions we've asked and the questions we have. Our discussion will continue on to Monday, January 23rd, and we are hoping on Thursday, January 26th, to have a vote on the budget. At that point, the budget becomes the school committee budget, and that is what gets presented to our town's finance committee and town meeting. Get any of that wrong, Dr. Doherty?
You're right on.
All right. Good. So that is where we are at. The only other thing I'll say is that conversations over the next few weeks might be challenging, and this is a moment where we all have to recommit ourselves to civil, respectful discourse. I think that's going to be important as we pull together as a community and face what is a very challenging situation. So I will start with public comment. Is there anyone here tonight who would like to address the committee on an item not on the agenda?
Ms. Borowski, is there one more chair in here? Because there's people outside. There's
one more chair.
We have two chairs in here.
Okay, there are, for people who are outside the room, there are actually chairs in the room. Maybe you can point them out. And there's some over in the back if you guys want. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Webb. Okay, it looked like nobody was here to talk about non-budgetary matters. So, moving on to the consent agenda.
Is there anyone that would like anything taken off the consent agenda?
Can I just give one clarification?
Yes.
The donation tonight from Ms. Janowski is not just for elementary, it's for middle school library as well.
Wonderful.
That was an error in the...
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
All those in favor? The vote 6-0. We certainly thank Mr. and Ms. Janowski for a very generous donation of Maker Studio software licenses to the two middle schools and the elementary school. That's a really wonderful donation. Reports. Alex, how are you doing?
So tomorrow night there's a basketball game at 6 o'clock in the field house, and in addition to just the basketball game, the RMHS singers will be singing the national anthem. So it's a great way to support both sides, both aspects of the school. Also, it was really cold in the school today, as well as outside, and a lot of people have been talking about the changes coming, so that we're going to hear about.
Thank you. Any liaison reports from the subcommittee?
Yeah, okay.
The CPAC had a meeting scheduled that was postponed for last Saturday, so keep your eyes open for the next scheduled meeting. And just another invitation for the Martin Luther King Day event that's coming up next Monday, 9:30, free breakfast, free program. Awesome reason to be there. Great man to celebrate who changed our world. So hope to see you at the Performing Arts Center for the Martin Luther King Day celebration. Sponsored by the Reading Public Schools and the Human Relations Advisory Committee.
Thanks, Dr. Boxer. Anything else from the committee this evening? All right, Dr. Doherty, I'll turn it over to you and the administrative team.
Okay, I'm gonna actually stand so that I can see what I'm gonna be presenting.
Would you have reports first?
I have no reports.
It says that you're releasing some executive session minutes.
Oh, yes, I am. I'm sorry. I'm so focused on this.
I know.
So, yes, I am releasing tomorrow some executive session minutes, again, from the litigation. I'll be releasing the ones that are listed there. We had had to temporarily suspend the website because there was some information that we need to take a look at and redact that was posted. So we're going to be looking at that. And then we'll probably have it up and running, hopefully by the end of the day tomorrow.
So hopefully the executive session minutes for the TLT lawsuit
correct.
Will be on the website
correct.
By tomorrow.
And we do apologize for the delay, but with everything else that's been going on, this kind of slowed down our...
Mr. Janowski, maybe it would be a good idea, just so everybody knows the purpose of redacting why we'd be doing it.
Okay. I'll take this.
Sure.
You jump in if you have anything to add. When the school committee meets in executive session, we can only meet in executive session, which means off camera, in private, by state law for a couple of very specific reasons. Contract negotiations is one, litigation strategy is another. We do keep careful minutes during those executive sessions, and then after whatever the thing was that required the meeting to not be public is over, we publish the minutes so that the public can see what happened during those meetings and what the thought process is and who said what, whatnot. There are times when we meet in executive session for multiple purposes. So we might meet to discuss litigation strategy and contract negotiations. So as a result, when we release the minutes about topic A, we need to redact the information about topic B until such time as that can be public. So that is that answer?
Oh, yeah.
Dr. Nyan? So that's the situation. That's it for reports. Thank you, Ms. Stock.
Could you just clarify, would these be the minutes that was raised in last committee meeting that there was an issue with the code? So if you could clarify that for
It's us? A great question, and I haven't looked into it personally over the weekend.
So
a town meeting member appeared and
so
said...
So we have been going through all of the minutes that were in question. There are some minutes that we missed, and we will be releasing those as well. So every set of minutes that was involved with the TLT litigation will be made public through the best of our knowledge. If there are other minutes out there, we'll be more than happy to release them, which is what I said the last one.
Yep. And the town meeting member who came last week, I exchanged emails with him over the weekend, so I'm in touch with him and making sure he's getting everything he thinks he needs and is appropriate.
There are 57 or so sets of minutes going all the way back to 2003, so you can imagine that, you know, there's a lot to go through.
10 years of minutes.
Yeah.
And as we were saying, to make sure that you publish what's appropriate, but not what
correct.
Cannot be published. Anything else for reports? All right. FY18 budget.
Okay. So I am gonna stand. So what I want to do this evening, I've divided the presentation up into sections, and at the end of each section, there is an amount of there's a pause which gives you the ability to ask questions. So if I can get through one piece of the presentation, then we can stop, ask
yep.
questions, answer the questions, and then move on to the next piece. There will be a lot of information tonight. You have in front of you a budget book. This budget book is the superintendent's recommended budget. I do use the word recommended lightly, and I'll get into that more later. You'll notice that the budget book is a lot thinner than in previous years, and the purpose, the reason for that is that we purposely tried to focus more on the financial and the human resource piece of the budget this year. We took out a lot of the non-financial information. We streamlined it. We removed some redundancy that has been in previous budget books. So what you see here really is the true financial and human resource picture of the Reading Public Schools. We still do have in here a section on our focus areas and our school improvement plan and district improvement plan pieces. That piece is still in there because that does connect to the budget. We also have the superintendent's introductory message, which is the beginning, which kind of outlines the story behind this year's budget. And then we get right into a snapshot of the financial. We then go into the organizational section and then the whole financial section. So I hope you find that the changes make it a little bit more streamlined so that you can get the information in a more easily accessible and timely manner. I do want to take this moment to also thank our administrators, directors, central office administrators for the time and effort that we have been going through since essentially late October when the override, the ballot question, was defeated by the voters. I think it's important to note that as a group of administrators, we have been struggling through this process for the last 2 months. We have gone through several drafts of what you're going to see tonight. And throughout each of the conversations that we had as a district leadership team, the focus was always on kids. And unfortunately, we came to the following conclusion at the end, is that no matter what we presented tonight, it was going to be not good for kids. What you're seeing tonight, what we feel is the least of the bad for kids. None of this tonight that we are presenting, and I want to make that very clear to everyone in this room and everyone that's watching, is something that we want to move forward. But given the fiscal realities that we're in of this community right now, we don't have a choice. And we're presenting to you a budget that we feel will be the least impactful of the worst, and be able to do still next year what we would want to do as a school district within the fiscal constraints. I do want to thank one more person. I want to thank Gail Dowd. This is her first budget, not really probably the budget that she wanted to have as her first budget, but Gail has done an amazing job since she's come in to get up to speed very quickly on Munis, and also to get up to speed very quickly on the numerous DESE codes that are required in order to put a budget together. And I think you will see her fingerprints all over this budget in terms of the work that's being done. So I want to thank her for all of her time and effort in this process. So what I'm going to do tonight is I'm going, and some of this Ms. Borowski already went through, so I'm going to go through this part very quickly and as we move forward. Really, this is a budget process timeline. And as I said earlier, you know, once we knew the results of the ballot question, we had to move forward. On November 2nd, the financial forum was held to really determine what was going to be the funding for town and schools for the FY18 budget. And I'm going to go into that financial data during this presentation. You'll see the schedule, as Ms. Borowski talked about, that's going to be the dates that the budget is going to be, presentations are going to be discussed. By February 1st, the budget needs to be submitted to the town manager. That is then the school committee budget. And by April, or late April, early May, town meeting will be voting on a budget with a set of recommendations from the finance committee. So why are we in this situation? First of all, we know as a community that revenues can only increase 2.5% each year. That's Proposition 2.5. It's a lot. It's been in place since the 1980s, plus new growth. And we know that Reading has that challenge of not having a large commercial tax base, and that new growth is limited due to the lack of buildable land for commercial property. And I know that the town is working very hard to find ways to get more economic development
which would increase that new growth. We also have expenses that go up higher than that 2.5%. Expenses like health insurance and other costs, which puts a strain on the other remaining funds for the operating budgets. Our Chapter 70 funding, which is the main education state funding source that goes to communities, is not sufficient. Here in Reading, because we've reached what is called the foundation level, and I'm going to show you a graph in a minute, we receive what's called the hold harmless amount of about $25 per student. Comes out to about $100,000 increase per year. We know that the override did not pass in October, which was to solve the structural deficit. We talked a lot this summer about the structural deficit and that the schools would have a structural deficit of about $2 million if no free cash was used for the town and school budgets. So this has been the Chapter 70 education funding since FY07. And you could see that in the early years, FY07, FY08, even FY10, that we were getting a significant increase in Chapter 70 funding. But the last 3 years, which is ironically the 3 years that we have been making reductions to our budgets each year from our level service budgets, you can see that we've received about 1%. When you look at comparable communities, and when we, you're going to see a lot of Department of Elementary Secondary Education reports tonight. Those are FY15. They are not current. They are not next year. And the state is usually 2 years behind because it all depends on the end of the year reports being submitted in a timely manner by each community. So this is the FY18 per pupil expenditure with comparable communities. We use as comparable communities the Middlesex League, plus other communities that have similar government structure as us, similar demographics, similar property values as a community. You could see that in FY15, the per pupil expenditure for Reading was 27th out of 30. Also, if you take a look at the FY15 numbers for where we rank among all of the communities, we actually have bumped up a little bit. We're at 291. We used to be at 305 or at 291. So we have moved up a little bit in the whole state. Before I go any further, because there always seems to be confusion, even last week when I was having presentations to staff about the different types of funds, I think it's important to do a little budget 101. And that there are really three types of funds when we talk about budgets and how things get spent and what you can spend them on. So the first one is operating budget. And that's really where we're going to focus most of our conversations this month, is the operating budget. It's the budget that's in this book. Those are the types of things that are your salaries, materials, supplies, services needed to operate the school district. The revenue comes from property taxes, state aid, excise tax, fees, things like that. And as I said earlier, they can only go up total, the revenue 2.5% plus new growth. And any funds at the end of the fiscal year need to be returned to the town's general fund. So there may be situations where, for example, we may have budgeted a little bit more in special education. If that's the case, then at the end of the year, that money would get turned back to the town. Sometimes we do try to use funds to purchase additional materials and supplies that we know we're going to need for the following year to help relieve some strain on that budget, and we've done that with things like technology and things like that. So that's one type of funds. Capital funds. Capital funds usually is around 5% of the operating budget. I believe in next year's budget it's a little bit less. And it really funds any capital improvement projects. The town and schools have a 10-year capital plan that the director of facilities, Joe Huggins, oversees. And it's used to replace roofs and windows and carpeting and things that have a lifespan of longer than 5 to 10 years. It also is for purchases such as fire trucks, things like that. One of the things that's important to note about the capital fund is that this is where the RMHS litigation will be funded for the next 10 years. And if you remember, in the $6 million, $3 million of that was paid for out of a combination of the remaining funds in the high school project and free cash, so that was about $3 million. The other $3 million is going to be eventually borrowed and paid for through the capital funds. What that means is projects that may have been occurring next year or the year after will be delayed a year or two or more depending on the project. So that will be the impact. The litigation itself will not have an impact on the actual operating budget, and I think that's important for people to know. And then the last area of funds that you will hear us talking about are grants and revolving funds. And those are usually for a specific purpose. There are some grants we receive every year, such as federal entitlement grants, such as IDA grant, or Title I or Title IIA. Those grants can be used for can only be used for specific purposes. Some of it is to fund positions, like the IDA grant does fund several special education positions in our district, and in your budget book, it outlines all of those positions that are funded through the grants. So that's one type of funding. Then we have revolving accounts. We have 7 revolving accounts that we use as offsets to our budget. And one of the things you're going to hear tonight, and that you, as you know from last year, is that we need to make sure that our revolving accounts are sustainable, that we are taking the amount of funds necessary out of the revolving account that allows it to continue to be sustainable. There are a few revolving accounts that this year we had to actually decrease the offset in because they could end up having a negative balance either at the end of this fiscal year or in subsequent fiscal years. Revolving fund accounts can only be used for the purpose of the fee or tuition that it was paid for. So for example, when someone is paying a tuition for kindergarten, full-day kindergarten, it can only be used for the purpose of the personnel, the supplies and the materials that are associated with the paid portion of full-day kindergarten. You also cannot use revolving funds for things like for personnel or positions that may not be connected to that. So we cannot use funding from extended day to pay for a teacher during the day. It's an inappropriate use of funds. It would actually be illegal. So those are really the three types of funds that we're always talking about with the school department budget. And sometimes people get confused because they see this money sitting in a revolving account. Why can't we use that money to pay for something in the operating budget because you're making cuts? And the answer is legally we can't. So the budget process, as it unfolded this year, what I want to do is I want to go over a little bit on some of the numbers as to why we got where we were and how we came up with the amount of reduction that we had to get to. So here's a projection of the revenues this year that are projected for FY18. You can see that you have a combination of things, property taxes, other local revenues, which include excise tax. Your intergovernmental revenues is your state aid, which Chapter 70, you can see is a major part of that. You can see it's scheduled to go up about 2.2% in FY18. I think an important thing to note is that in the FY18 budget, we are seeing about a 50% decrease in the amount of free cash that's being used. So in the last few years, there's been a significant amount of free cash used in 15, 16, 17. You can see 1.7 million, 2.2, 2.1. in FY17, the current fiscal year. But next year, because of a variety of factors, there is less free cash being used. The Finance Committee authorized the use of $1.1 million of free cash. So that is part of what we're dealing with. If you remember, during the summer when we were talking about the structural deficit, we were talking about that the schools would need about $2 million for the structural deficit if no free cash was being used. So we're going to get to that number shortly. The other thing that we look at is the accommodated costs. And you could see that there are some things that are higher than the 2.5%, benefits being one of them at 5.4%. That's mostly the health benefits. But you could see some other things are actually less than 2.5%. The one accommodated cost that is connected to the schools is special education. I think you'll see there that special education tuition and transportation, out-of-district tuition and transportation, is actually down 2.3%. As we know, special education out-of-district placements can be a very up-and-down process. This year, through the hard work of Carolyn, and that we did have some students aging out, the amount of tuition needed actually went down. But there are other years where it could increase. If you have a student moving in that may require an out-of-district placement or something like that, that can change very quickly. So, but this year, it did have a decrease. It's down to minus 2.3% from last year. And then when you take a look at the whole revenue projection, and I know there's a lot of numbers here, but the number I want you to follow the most is the number at the bottom. The number at the bottom, when you take the accommodated costs and you subtract it from the available revenue, which was the first slide, what is left over is then split between town and schools. The percentage is 64% and 36% approximately. And then you put back in the accommodated costs that the school has. You can see this number at the bottom under total expenses, $41,301,662, or 1.4% increase. That is the number that was discussed at the financial forum in early November. So that's the first part. We know the number. The second part is, what will it take in funds to run the same programs and courses and classes that we're doing this year, next year, when you factor in normal increases to a budget? And so we built a budget from the bottom up. We put in the increases that we felt were necessary and comparable, and what we came up with was not a 1.4% increase, but a 4.91% increase. So the deficit that we're looking at is approximately a $1.4 million deficit. Now, if you take that $1.4 million and you take the amount of increase from FY17 to FY18, it's about a $600,000 increase. There's your $2 million structural deficit. So the deficit that we were talking about this summer was a real number. The reason why it's not two is because free cash was infused into both town and school budgets this year to help lessen that impact. As you know, this isn't the first year that we have had to make reductions. We've actually been making reductions since FY13. And we have tried as much as possible to stay away from the classroom. And you could see that the bottom line is the amount that we have had to reduce from our level service budgets each year. The current fiscal year, if you remember from a year ago when we were having these discussions, we had to reduce it by $645,000. We've also tried to make a lot of non-personnel reductions and offset increases to help lessen that impact, and non-teaching positions. And you could see that up until FY17, we pretty much were able to stay away from the classroom. Unfortunately, this current year, we had to make 6.3 FTE reductions, mostly at the high school and at the elementary school. There was also a half a FTE at the middle school. Unfortunately, this year we do not have those non-personnel expenses, those offset increases, to be able to rely on anymore. We are at the critical levels to be able to continue to run the school district next year in those areas. So we had no other options but to take a look back into personnel reductions, which is why we are where we are today. So the drivers for the budget, as we were developing our FY18 budget, is all of the salary and benefit obligations through collective bargaining, both for represented and non-represented personnel. Should note for everyone in the audience and at home that the last year of the collective bargaining agreements ends in June. So the school committee is in the process of going through the negotiation process for all five collective bargaining units. We also have some increases in some things like regular day mandatory transportation. We also have decreases in offsets, as I mentioned earlier, for athletics. If we didn't change that decrease, we would end up with a negative balance at the end of this year. and we could certainly talk about that at a future meeting. Extracurricular activities, use of school properties, and kindergarten revolving accounts. So all of those accounts, we had to reduce the offset to the budget, which means we actually had to decrease our budget revenue coming in, which increased the gap of what we had to reduce and cut for funds. We also saw an increase in athletic expenses. We saw an increase in rental fees for a pool and ice rink, as well as athletic transportation. And we also have a decrease in the offset for the METCO grant. So I want to take a minute and explain the METCO grant. I also have Jason here tonight. If I mess anything up, let me know, all right? So we receive an amount of funding each year, state funding, to fund the METCO program. We have approximately 75 Boston students that come here as part of their educational experience in Reading. And there are several communities that are part of the METCO program. There is a pool of funding that is used out of the METCO grant for transportation. There's a pool of funding that is used to pay for the director's salary and also for professional development, for programs for the Boston students, for professional development for diversity education, but also for after-school transportation for students that they can stay after school. As there was an increase in regular day transportation, we also had an increase in the METCO bus transportation. So what happened was the amount of funding that the state gave us for METCO transportation was not sufficient. So we had to actually use the other pool of money that the state gives us to help offset some of the increase in the METCO transportation costs. We usually take an offset, and it varies each year, but this year we are taking an offset to the budget of $100,000. That fund is used, in theory, it has helped to offset the costs of teachers that teach all of the students K through 12. This year, next year's budget, we have to decrease it to $60,000. So the decrease of $40,000 is the piece that that is going to have an impact. So here are some things that are not included in the budget, and the one piece there that I just want to make sure people are aware of is that we did not include the funding for the second year of the K through 12 science curriculum implementation at $150,000. If you recall, at town meeting last April, $150,000 was approved by town meeting to fund the first phase of science curriculum implementation, which ended up being grades 3 through 6 and a little bit in grades 7 and 8. That had to be, the durable goods had to be purchased by the end of the fiscal year, which it was. And those things are now being implemented in all of our grade 3 through 5 and grade 6 classrooms. Logically, we wanted to put year 2 in this next budget in FY18, and this is not in the FY18 budget at this point. Other things that are not included in the budget, and these are things that normally you would not include in your budget, and it would be something that you would go to either town meeting or to finance committee for an emergency fund transfer, would be unanticipated enrollment increases or extraordinary special education costs, and those are not built into this budget. So as we were developing this budget, these are the areas that became the priorities with the limited funding that we had, and I should mention that even in these priorities, not all of the areas are fully funded. The four focus areas that are in our district improvement plan, which was approved by the school committee in the fall, keeping class sizes to 18 to 22 students in K to 2, the middle school interdisciplinary teaming model, ensuring that high school juniors and seniors have access to coursework for graduation next year. They're at the end of their K to 12 careers, and making sure they have access to the courses that they need, and the Josh Reaton School Improvement Plan process. You heard a presentation by Principal Sprung last week that talks about the things that are happening at Josh Reaton and how we need to continue to support those things in various ways. So one of the ways that we take a look at our budget is through the cost centers. And what you're going to see throughout the budget book is two ways that we're showing you the funding. One is through the five cost centers, and then under each cost center, you're going to see different categories. So this will be the first piece. So we're kind of working our way down from a 30,000-foot level down closer and closer to more line item detail. So the first, what you see here in these five cost centers, and we'll go into much more detail during the evening presentations. So the administration cost center, you're seeing a decrease in next year's requested budget of 3.8%. Regular day is going to be a 0.5% increase. Special ed, you see, is a 3% increase. There's a decrease in school facilities and an increase in district-wide programs. The reasons for these increases and decreases deal with a variety of factors, which I've mentioned some of these already. Reduction in positions, decreases in offsets, increases in expenses for different cost centers. Throughout the presentation, I'll be going into detail in each of these areas. So first, the administration cost center. These are the major changes. You can see it's a decrease of about $37,000. What you see in this cost center are cost of living adjustments for the central office administrative assistants, the interim director of human resources, and the director of finance. There is no funding budgeted for cost of living adjustments for the superintendent or the assistant superintendent in this budget. There is also a reduction of an administrative assistant, the school business assistant, in this budget, and there is a reduction in legal costs. Those are the major changes in the administration cost center that leads to the decrease in this area. The regular day cost center, the major changes that you see about an increase of $116,000. Built into the budget are cost of living adjustments according to collective bargaining agreements for any of the staff that would be funded in this cost center, including regular education teachers, regular education paraeducators and tutors, and school secretaries. Those are the personnel that would be funded out of this budget. There's also cost of living adjustments for non-represented personnel, which would be basically building level administrators. There is, unfortunately, 18.1 FTE reductions in this cost center, and I'll be going into much more detail later on. There's also a reduction in professional development expenses, and in this cost center are the decreases that I mentioned earlier involving the offset to the MECO grant, the decrease in the offset to full-day kindergarten. The special education cost center, this is an increase of $372,000. Again, you have your collective bargaining cost of living adjustments that are in this cost center for both represented and non-represented employees. There are two special education teachers that are built into this budget. Those are actually had to be put in this year for caseload reasons and additional IEPs at Joshua Eaton and at Wood End. We did see a decrease in special education out-of-district tuitions in this budget, which is the result of that accommodated cost going down that I mentioned earlier. There is a decrease, actually an elimination of professional development in this cost center, a reduction of a 0.5 special education administrator team chair, and a proposed increase of 5% for RISE tuition, which results in a $50,000 increase in the offset. There has not been an increase in the RISE tuition since, I believe, 2009-10 timeframe. School facilities is a decrease of $6,500. Again, you have your cost of living adjustments. This is primarily school custodians are in this cost center. Remember that the facilities budget has now been split into three different budgets. You have your school custodian budget, which is under the school department, the core budget, which is now under the town, which is all of the major facility pieces, including utility costs and the personnel, maintenance personnel, and the director and the assistant director's salaries are in that core group. And Mr. Huggins will be presenting that next week. And then you have the town custodians, which is also under the town budget. So this is a very small cost center now. And there is an $80,000 reduction in the Reading Memorial High School cleaning contract for next year. And we also had to decrease the offset for the use of school properties because that offset was starting to reach, the revolving account itself was starting to reach a negative balance, and we need to keep an eye on that. So we need to make it more sustainable. And then the district-wide programs cost center, which is actually four smaller cost centers in one. You have your health services, which is your school nurses. You have your athletics, extracurricular activities, and district-wide technology and networking. This is an increase of $119,000. Again, you have your cost of living adjustments for represented and non-represented staff. You do have increases in athletic transportation and pool and ice rental. There is a reduction of a technician from the district-wide technology cost center. $35,000 reduction of technology hardware and services. And then we have offsets. We have a decrease in the offset for athletic revolving account, which is a net of $21,000. We are also proposing a $75 increase per student per sport in user fees, and also a proposed increase of $25 per student per activity for high school band and drama. And this is to offset the increases that I mentioned earlier in athletics and extracurricular. When you take a look at how this is broken up, the total pie, 60% of the budget is in regular day, 31% is in special education, 4% is in district-wide programs, 3% in school facilities, and 2% is administration. This is the second category that I referred to earlier, and how we're going to be breaking down the funds. So under each of the cost centers, it's broken down by category. So we funnel down now to the next layer, and you can see that the categories are professional salaries, clerical salaries, other salaries, then your contract services, supply materials, and other expenses. And you can see that the professional salaries is the bulk of your budget. This is your teachers, your administrators, other professional staff. Your clerical salaries are your secretaries and administrative assistants. Other salaries include paraeducators, substitute teachers, custodians, those types of salaries. Your contracted services include a variety of things, including bus transportation and out-of-district tuitions and transportation, things like that. And then your supplies and materials is one what runs the day-to-day operations of your schools. And then other expenses include dues and memberships and other areas, which are broken down. So you can see, again, it brings us back to the 1.4% increase in the total. So now I'm going to get into the reductions. In each cost center, I'm going to get into the impact. So I'm not going to go specifically into impact right now, but what I am going to talk about are, here are the specific reductions in the budget so that everyone's aware of them. So in regular day, there will be a reduction of 2 elementary classroom teachers. In the middle schools, we're looking at a reduction of 7 classroom teachers. At the high school, it's 3.8 classroom teachers. And Rise Preschool, it's 0.6 classroom teacher, for a total of 13.4 FTE. In terms of other staff reduction, we do have a 1.0 reduction in administration. It's a school business assistant. We do have 3.3 FTE reduction for kindergarten paraeducators, a 1.0 FTE supervisor of students, which is here at the high school, the technician, which I mentioned earlier, instructional coach under regular day, a 0.5 special education team chairperson. That's an additional 7.8 FTE reductions. Non-personnel reductions, and I've mentioned several of these already, the cleaning service, the technology hardware and computer services, and then professional development expenses. And then we are also recommending user fee tuition increases for athletics, extracurricular, band drama, special education, increase in the RISE tuition. So that gives you an overview of the entire budget and the reductions. So at this point, I want to take questions on anything I've talked about so far.
Yeah. Well, first of all, Dr. Daugherty and Gail, thank you for putting this together. It's a lot of work. You did it fast, and we appreciate getting us to this meeting with this information. I wanted to go back through the slides and maybe just take them in order, and
sure.
I'll just go through my questions if that's all right. I'll ask a question, and then maybe we can let other people speak. I can come back.
Idea.
So let me just ask. This is an increase in spending for the schools, right? The actual proposed budget with all these cuts that you're proposing to the school committee tonight, this represents an increase in overall funding, correct?
1.4%.
Thank you.
$565,000.
Right. And the level service that you compare this proposal to is an increase of how much?
4.91%.
So you feel we need 4.91% more money than last year to provide the same experience resources to the district that we had.
Correct.
This year. But you're only asking for 1.4% increase.
No, I'm not asking for 1.4%. 1.4% is what the town is recommending. What I'm presenting to you is a budget that is within the fiscal realities of the town.
Which is 1.4%.
Correct.
And
I'm going to interrupt.
Yes.
To clarify, that's based on guidance you received.
Correct.
From the town manager and the finance.
Correct.
Committee. So they looked at incoming revenue projections, took out the accommodated costs you talked about earlier, and said approximately 2/3 goes to the school, 1/3 goes to the town. Schools, you're looking at just over 500,000.
Correct.
So that's the process.
Correct.
And you managed to that.
Yes.
Does that make sense, Mr. Ross?
Okay.
Yep.
So that process was a public process.
Absolutely.
At the financial committee holds a financial forum. That was
November 2nd.
Thank you. And so, I mean, just to be really clear, that was a public process. There were people there sort of talking about this issue, and this is where it ended up in terms of the guidance from the financial committee and the town.
And same topic, but follow up question, and then I'm out for this one. The slide that says budgetary reductions FY13 to 17, it's page 6 of the handout, looks like that.
Yep.
Okay, so the bottom line there.
Yes.
Those are comparisons of reductions against the superintendent's proposed budgets this year and the school committee's budgets from past year, correct?
Correct.
So, were there actually budget increases year over year in those 5 years?
Yes, because those are reductions from level service budgets.
So the actual increase year over year was, does 2.4% average sound right over 5 years?
2.51.
2.5, so even higher. So it's 2.51% higher, and then a recommendation.
Actually, no, you may be right, 2.4, because with FY12, I think it's 2.51, I think so.
So just to be clear, and this is my last point, just to make sure I understand this, we've spent 2.4% more year over year for the schools on average for the last 5 years. For those figures, superintendent has recommended more spending, school committee has adopted budgets that made the point that they'd recommend more for level service, and this year's level service budget is 4.91% more, but with all the cuts we're going to talk about in your proposal, it's still a 1.4% increase.
Correct.
Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Robinson.
Just, can you go back to the revenue projections slide? I just have the clarification that.
This one? That one? Or the
page
one?
Page 5.
That one?
Yeah, so the free cash, is that the net free cash numbers? Or because I think that's important. Did we spend 2.1 million in FY16? Or was that before we sent back to free cash?
No, this is the free cash that's used total for town and schools.
Right,
this is
but
not
okay, so the town and school, is that the amount that was used? Or
yes,
the net
that was
amount?
The amount that was used.
Okay. And I have.
Can I just clarify? So if it's the net amount, then that's net of what might have been returned in those budget years?
So my question is, so that the finance committee's authorized 1.1 million this year.
Correct.
Okay. If we didn't spend all of that, which in other years we've done that, where we haven't used all of our, but not all of our budget we've given, so the net amount that the town and the schools uses in free cash has historically been lower than what is authorized in the beginning. You follow?
Yes.
So all I'm trying to, I just can't remember. I can go back and check. I just can't remember whether that, go back to FY16, whether that 2.199 was what was authorized or what the final amount was.
I believe that was the final amount that was used.
So it was probably.
Those are actuals.
Yeah, there's 118,000 that we returned.
So, yeah, okay.
Mrs. Webb, did you have something?
No, I was trying to make sure I understood Mr.
I'm just thinking for down
yep.
the road here.
I see what you're saying.
So, can I just go to the on the budget slide 7? Sorry.
What's the title of the slide?
Budget drivers for, it's actually page 7 in our book. Budget drivers for the FY18.
This one?
Yeah. So. On the third bullet down, can you just explain that again? I missed that. So
the bus transportation that we are required to provide.
Oh, I know what it is. I just, why is it, what's the purpose of the increase?
It's a bus contract. We're in a multi-year bus contract. We're in year 2. I believe it's around a 5% increase.
Okay, is there any chance that we can go back to the bus company and say, you know, we're in trouble here, we need some help, and try to renegotiate?
When we went out to bid, they were the only company that bid for it.
Right, we'll talk about that some more too then.
It does affect not just regular day, but it affects Metco transportation and
right.
athletic transportation. So it's all our transportation. It's the same bus company.
Okay, so on I just had another question.
Yeah,
on
fine.
The next slide, I guess I didn't understand the with the science curriculum. We bought the materials for FY18. We just purchased them in June. Before
FY17, for this current school year.
We
town meeting approved.
Right, that was
additional
a year
funding
ago.
In April.
Right. Okay. So, because we made it pretty clear that we weren't gonna the way it sounds here, and I hope I'm misunderstanding it, is that we're not going forward with the science curriculum. Is that?
I didn't say that. What I'm saying is we are not putting in this budget $150,000. We are going to continue to do best we can to move forward in the implementation, but we do not at this point have in the budget $150,000. If we put that in, we would have to cut $150,000 more from the budget.
I have a follow-up on that one. The year 2 implementation was, if I recall, supposed to be grades kindergarten through 2 and 7 through 8. Is that correct? And then year 3 was the final year, which was to be the high school year.
In 8th grade.
So just to be clear, we're talking about $150,000 expenditure in FY18?
Right.
And then in 19, and then it's over. These are two one-time expenses.
Yes, correct.
Not
correct.
Ongoing operating
correct.
Expenses. Mrs. Webb?
I just wanted to clarify what the programmatic pieces were year over year.
So that was the answer?
Yeah,
okay.
I think as long as
so,
what Gene says.
All right, so I just, when we talked about this, we all agreed that we weren't going to spend the first year if we couldn't follow the whole thing through. So
if the committee wants me to
I'm just
forward.
I'm making a comment. I'm not
right.
telling you now. I'm just
right.
put
My,
that out there.
I think
Gary,
this was
and
this is one of the struggles we had.
Yeah.
We, as you can see, have several personnel reductions in this budget.
Yeah.
And this is one of the struggles that we faced as we were going through this over the last several months as an administrative team. Do we move forward with science curriculum implementation, or do we make more personnel cuts that were already going to be very difficult? We chose not to move forward with the additional funds. It doesn't mean we're not going to try to do things. We're going to keep trying to do things. It may look differently. It's not going to be at that level, but we're going to keep doing the best we can. So that was
okay.
a decision we made as part of our recommendation.
I think another argument for that that approach is that if you cut two positions that were intended to exist indefinitely into the future for two one-time expenses, that I look at curriculum purchases like this as a one-time,
right,
in this case over 3 years, but they're one-time expenses. They aren't ongoing operating expenses the way a position is. That's a difference, just in terms of the financing of it. Dr. Nye?
Do we know how much money we've returned to the town at the end of each budget year?
Yeah, it's in the budget book.
So,
I have it there.
It was $118,000 last FY16 and $248 FY15.
What page is that?
And $593 FY14. It's on page 34 of the book.
So, essentially, though, so we could count on some of those potentially funds to purchase the science curriculum.
Yeah, as we mentioned to you when we did our first quarterly budget projection, we are going to try to do some things this year if we have the funding to do them. I don't know if that's important.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if that's the case, but what I'm trying to explain to the committee is that we have not put a line item in FY18 for science curriculum.
Right. And I think that's a good idea, but I do think, you know, it's fair to say that we're going to try to do that by looking at expenditures that we can save potentially.
Right.
Use those at the end of the year as opposed to turning it back into
correct.
The town.
Correct.
As we have in the past.
So I think it's important that those, when we've done that, it's a one time. It's not like, unfortunately, not like if we had additional money that we would probably be able to say we could put the math instructional coach back. We wouldn't be doing something that's an ongoing expense. It would be something that is a one time.
Yeah.
Just since we're still, I understand what Dr. Nye is saying, but you know, when we made this decision to take the science curriculum, we knew what was happening this year and next year, and that there was a potential override. So we went into that decision knowing that we had a precarious financial position going. So it's not like all of a sudden we found out about, oh, and that's so. You know, I still think that's something we should talk, because that's a commitment we made to the community, that we were going to, you know, we weren't going to spend it 1 year and then not be able to do it for the 3 years. So I just throw that out.
Yeah, Mr. Martin has wanted to jump in.
Well, I just want to, I think we're on the same page, but just in case, I just want to make sure that we clarify to Mr. Roberts' point. I think, Ms. Borowski, you made the point that we're looking at different grade levels. That as our overall 3-year implementation, we were looking at implementing things at different grade levels. So I don't want people to think, so right now, for instance, last year we have grades 3, 4, 5, and 6 online with different curriculum materials. We are not anticipating next year that that's going away. That we absolutely do want.
And you will see in the budget that we have
that we
that
absolutely
piece is funded.
Want that to continue. We still have things that we're exploring for grades K-2, 7-8 somewhat in the high school. So that's still a work in progress. So to your point, we're not undoing what we've done, but we still need to explore and talk about the grade levels that we haven't yet implemented new materials for, if that helps clarify some of that. Okay.
So can I just, I guess when we had that whole discussion, and I was confused because I thought part of that discussion, we knew full well what the situation was going to be in. I don't know if we were talking with FinCom or it was financial forum. I sort of had thought that we, in talking with FinCom, that it would be like, okay, if we get into that situation, we would be able to go back to them and like ask them for that $150,000. I think I'm remembering that in a potentially unrealistic, optimistic manner. So I just feel like I understand totally where what we committed to, and I know that Dr. Daugherty was in the district when Dr. Hartunian was here, and we went through multiple times of start a curriculum, stop a curriculum, start a curriculum, and teachers were just burnt out about it. And we don't really want to do that, but if it sounds like this is, you know, maybe just a throttling back, if we can do it and maintain what we have and a throttling back of the approach, then that might be the best that we can do this year, unless we're going to be able to get additional funding from the financial committee or the town.
As I recall, the original plan was $500,000 total over 3 years to be funded through free cash, 150 in year one, 150 in year two, 150 in year three. That was the original approach that we took.
Mm-hmm.
And then it turned out that there were some additional funds at the end of the last fiscal year. If we purchased before June, it allowed FinCom not to dig into free cash. So that was the approach we took. So you're right to remember that, and that is what I recall. But the circumstance around free cash has changed in the last year. Obviously, there was a rather large expense that came up. So that is a discussion for with FinCom. Oh, yes, Mr. Bonner.
Different topic. Can we go to the revenue projection slide, please, Dr. Frey? Let me make sure that it's really the only chance I think we have in the presentation to go through
that slide.
One prior. Before that. Yeah, there you go.
Yep.
Okay, so I'm going to go through the next three in order and ask some
just,
questions.
Just so you know, this is a town manager developed slide.
Of course. And I don't take questions with the numbers that come from the town here. I just want to make sure that we all understand how this is laid out and how the money's flowing from the taxpayer to the schools here. So this represents, as I understand it, our best understanding of town revenue, right? So this is not school specific. This is where the money comes into the town of Reading, right?
Right.
So we have about $66 million, or about 70% of those costs are property tax, right? Okay. So then that money comes in and we go to the next slide. So we get that money. Reading has that money. And the first thing that we do is we take out these accommodated costs, which are shared, as I understood it from your presentation, between all the different parts of the town. School is one part, rest of the town are other parts, right?
It's a budget model that we use to take those out first from the revenues.
So these are all shared. So one question I had about this slide was, is only the special education line school specific, or are all of these the portion of these categories that the school pays?
Special education is the only line item that's in our budget.
All right, so none of these other items are in the school budget that we're seeing?
Just
special education?
That is correct.
Okay.
But, can I?
Yeah.
So, but the school personnel benefits from
correct.
The benefit
yep.
line. We have capital in the capital line.
Utilities.
We have utilities, so.
Right.
So we do share a portion of all of these. We just
right,
don't
but they're not in
them.
Our budget.
Correct.
That's what I
want to be clear about.
In our
they're
budget.
Taken off
exactly.
the top, and then whatever's left is.
Thank you. And that's what I want to be clear about. So we don't pay for vocational education through the budget that you're recommending tonight.
No, we do not.
We do pay for all the special education here.
Correct.
In this budget. Everything else on here, although shared in part by the schools, is not within the scope of the proposed budget tonight. Thank you. Okay. Next one, revenue projections, last one. All right, so you talked about the split. So the number you had for special education, I wanna find that in here, okay? So we take the original number that we had for income and we deduct the accommodated costs, which included some, that one line for schools. We split what's left over between municipal and school, so 64% goes to school. And then we have a series of what you call non-accommodated expenses, meaning they're paid for entirely by this budget.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then we itemize those through a list here till we get to school expenses non-accommodated, and that's a total of everything above it, right? Up to
right.
non-accommodated.
Right.
All right. And then below that, we have school expenses accommodated, and we have three things in a row, right? We've got special education, which is a number that's different than the number before. Okay, so I assume that's like the gross number, like that's what we pay out. And then there are funds, the circuit breaker, that's
circuit
state
breaker
funds.
Circuit breaker helps defray the cost.
Yes,
from the state, right.
Okay, so
for
everyone understands it's not the Reading Municipal Light folks helping
no,
out.
No, I wish.
It's the state of Massachusetts.
And I should have explained that, I apologize. We receive from the state a reimbursement of expenses for students that cost $42,000 or above. We receive a percentage of that, and usually it's around 70% to 75%. So that is state funding that we receive to
okay.
help offset costs of special education.
Okay, so we take that, we do the subtraction, and we get this number here that you have for accommodated. Should that be the same number in the previous slide?
It should be. I think it's off by 9.
Okay.
Always.
So, but that's the same number. It's not. It's
number.
Not a different
yes.
number. It's tended to be the same number. Fine. And then we get the school committee's budget. That line item, the $40 million number.
Yep.
Okay, so that's the recommended budget. Where, how do we get from that to the 41 million below it when you say total expense?
The revolving accounts.
Thank you, okay. All right. I, hopefully that's helpful so people can understand. It took me a while to walk through that. So we start with all this revenue, 70% of that is property tax, and then if you multiply that 70% by the percent of the budgets going through accommodated costs, the rest passed through the school budget at 64%, you could calculate how much of everybody's property tax is going to each of these proposed line items. One last point about this, and I'll be done with it. You say school committee's budget. So FY 15, 16, and 17 are school committee budgets, but 18 is the superintendent's proposed budget.
Yes, project. That's why, yeah, it's project.
Okay, so it's not the school committee's budget, it's the proposed budget.
No, that's the way the town manager categorizes it when
okay.
he does his chart.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else from the committee? Yeah, Mr.
Gary, go ahead.
Oh, sorry, Dr. Ryan.
Sorry. So, I guess, you know, my general impressions after having talked to you regarding the budget, obviously, you know, we're dire straits to speak. I've been through this before, been in education since 1975. I've seen these ebb and flows. They're never fun and very discouraging. But one thing I have seen all the time are the same exact cuts. For example, physical education, music, foreign language, paraprofessionals.
We haven't gotten into that level of detail yet. That's in the when we do regular day. Yeah, we're going to get into specific
right.
reductions in regular day by level.
Right.
Mr. Rasmus. Yep. Oh, sorry. I promised Mr. Roberts.
Go ahead.
I guess I just wanted to go to the district priorities for a minute, the four focus areas. So I think two things, and I got through everything that you've given us, but I did get through the first about 25 or 27 pages in detail of the budget, and I want to say that I think that it's really important reading, you know, for all of us and for the community, for people that are interested, because there's a lot of detail and the rationale, and I think it speaks to the district priorities. And I guess the thing I just want to highlight here is these are the priorities. We're still not doing everything, and it doesn't mean that there's not going to be some pain in these areas as well. And we just have to recognize that I think what you've put together and what we're going to work through is, you know, hopefully to get to the best scenario we can. And I just wanted to thank you for, you know, I think there was a lot of dialogue that we had, that you had with the community, with budget parents, and for setting those priorities. And I can tell from the priorities that, you know, you took in what we were saying. So I just wanted to highlight that. I appreciate it.
Yes. Oh, sorry.
So actually, I had just a comment while we're on this. I think it's, you know, maybe as we get through the budget process, I see district not all areas are fully funded. If I were coming in this room and looking at that, I'd be concerned if I saw class size. I mean, there's nothing in here that proposes that class sizes K to 2 aren't going to be 18 to 22 students.
No, no.
So
what I'm saying is we're not able to fully fund
I think
some
we should,
of these areas.
Well, we can talk, but I think the slide should show what we're not fully funding and not necessarily. It's confusing.
Okay.
If you first look at that, it looks I saw that immediately and I said, that's not something we're gonna do. So maybe it's maybe
well,
I
mean, I could, I mean, mathematics instruction is gonna be affected.
I understand what you, but I think initially as you look at that, it could concern.
Okay. Wasn't there another slide or that says what we're more specifically what's
there
not
is.
Funded?
There
is
just something to think about.
Yeah, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to lay the foundation, I guess you could say, for as we get more and more specific. That's, I'm trying to, that's what I'm trying to do tonight.
And I just have one up final question. On the administrative cost center slide,
Page.
You just passed, there
yep.
you go. Reduction in legal costs, I just want to, again, put out there, is that realistic now that we're going into negotiating with our labor unions?
This is for next year.
Okay, right.
Yeah. So the thought being that the cost we have
will
this
come
year
down
for
that's,
this, and then we
that's our
expect
hope.
Them to
okay.
repeat next year.
Mr. Bobbin.
Yeah, so back to the priorities. Slide, please. Okay, so I guess my question is two questions. One, maybe you could give an overview of what the state of Massachusetts requires us to do in each of these areas and whether there are any requirements that are not on that list at a high level that we're required to do for our students. And secondly, how do you prioritize these priorities? So if we look at just the four focus areas, we have focus areas, which from last year's budget document and this year's, I counted 16 different bullet points under those four focus areas, four in each one, plus communication is 17 measures of success along with those, plus these four bullet points, which are somewhat more specific of class sizes, middle school, et cetera, that you have in this slide. So I'm up to about 39 different criteria in my mind that you could use. What are the ones that for you, you know, stand out when you made this budget? What were your priorities just from this list? And is there anything that the state would require that we have to fund that's not kind of like goes without saying that you're assuming is also built into this budget?
The state, well, I would say closing the achievement gap is probably the one that stands out, but I would say also a lot of the things below support closing the achievement gap.
So that's your number one of the 39 things,
say,
that's number one.
So I think if you look at a lot of the other things, those are all research-based practices that you would do to address closing the achievement gap. In terms of what's required by the state doesn't mandate that we have class sizes of 18 to 22. I believe the only class size requirement in the entire regulations is kindergarten can't be more, on average, of 25 students, greater than 25 students across a district. There are no regulations on class size. So that's one example.
Okay.
So all of the things we're listing here are things that we believe will help students achieve.
Okay. So
that's really our basis. It's not what the state is requiring. The state has a set of frameworks that we get assessed on. They don't say you have to teach those frameworks, but you do get assessed on, you know, on those frameworks and in a variety of ways.
Students get assessed.
Yeah, we. Students, yeah.
And if you had to
we
rank?
Also, I mean, special education is mandated,
okay.
But that isn't, I mean, because that's mandated. So that, to me, is already a given, and it's not listed yet.
That was my point. Was there things that's not on this list that we're doing
oh,
in
right,
this budget?
Absolutely.
That's where I'm going with
right.
that. And if you had to prioritize for our district from what you have on this, how would you do that as you created this budget? How are you, were these all equal? Did you have specific areas that you thought were, that you started with as being non-negotiable, or how did you approach this?
If you look at previous year's district priorities, that list is a lot longer. The list has now gotten much smaller. So what you see here is in no order of priority. It's, these are the things that we are holding on to as we're developing this budget. And obviously we couldn't even do that with some of the reductions we had to make.
Last question, what is fully funded? If not all these things are fully funded, what is fully funded on that list?
I would say the class sizes in K to two, we're hoping to keep that where it is. Maybe literacy. And we're, you know, we're obviously making strides and hopefully closing the achievement gap. That's our biggest goal. I do believe that, you know, in working with Mr. Barker, that our juniors and seniors will have access to the courses they need to graduate. And And we have been providing resources to Joshua Eaton, as we mentioned to you last time.
Thank you.
So I just wanted to comment that the resources to juniors and seniors in your comment earlier about how they all close the achievement gap, I guess it could, but one of the reasons that we were prioritizing that is because in past cuts of this nature, those students in particular bore a much greater burden of those years of failed overrides. And I think that it was really important that we not do that again to them, because I at least had seen it in several years when my kids were very young in the K to two, struggling with the kindergarten classes. So I think that it certainly does work to close the achievement gap, but it was also, I think, important that we not have them bear the burden as was done in 2001, 2002.
Dr. Nine.
Yeah, back to the administration cost center. So I noticed that you listed 1.0 full-time administrative assistant, which I believe we haven't really filled that position over the last 2 to 3 years at least. I know we used some of that.
It did not get filled last fiscal year, that's correct.
Well, and then, so since I've been on the committee, I don't think Martha, the previous finance director.
No, the position was filled. And when the person left in the middle of last year, we didn't fill it.
Last year?
Yeah, on purpose. We did it that way on purpose because we knew potentially we were going down a road of difficult budget. The other thing was that the responsibilities of the director of finance have changed. The previous director of finance oversaw facilities. The previous director, assistant superintendent before that, oversaw HR. Those are now both under the superintendent.
Correct. So.
So we also felt that we were reducing that position because things have shifted.
Right.
Responsibilities.
So what's not? I wouldn't consider it a significant administrative cut, though. Would you?
It's a major change in the cost center. It's a reduction of a position.
Right, but if I'm not mistaken, I'm hearing that it wasn't really valued. That we weren't going to do it because
no.
Okay,
what I'm doing in these presentations is I'm showing the major changes in the budget.
Oh, I understand.
This is a major change in the budget. The position's no longer there.
Okay, but what I'm saying is, I remember specifically when we hired Gail and Stubb, that we talked about using that funding to offset her salary, which would be higher than the previous one, based on her experience and. So I'm just not positive that I buy that as a true administrative cut. That's my perception on it.
We're making a reduction of a position of administrative assistant.
I think it's a little bit apples and oranges. Ms. Dowd's salary is budgeted in the budget and it's moved forward. So your salary is where it is. This is a position, I believe it was $40,000 a year.
Yeah, something like
that. That was in the budget but not used, and we're now cutting it from the budget. So I hear it.
Well, and did Dr. Daugherty indicate that some of that function was taken on by the superintendent, so some of the things were added to
the superintendent,
role.
The special education office, and the director of finance have essentially,
taken on the responsibilities
that
would be required from that if we had that one person.
You mean no matter how you kind of slice it, we're saving $40,000.
Correct.
It's $40,000 we were budgeting to spend out that we will not have to spend
well,
out.
Well, I guess I don't disagree with the fact that we're saving $40,000. What I'm saying is it was an easy cut to make. That's my perception on it.
I actually want to make the point that I don't think there's anything easy about it. I think that there's been additional responsibilities that our administration have taken on. It shows in the number of hours that they put into the work. I think this is a very difficult budget. I'm very grateful for the work that's been gone on and the iterations to get to where we are. But I think that it's not that we don't need that other position. I think that it's a way to save money so that other cuts aren't necessary. That's the way I understood it. And so I think that if we were budgeting that money and keeping it, then we could offset some of the demand on our administrators' time so that they could do maybe a more reasonable amount of work. But instead, we're cutting that and keeping the additional responsibilities on our administrators' plates, and I appreciate the extra work that's being taken on to save that $40,000. So I do think that it's still a cut from the budget.
And you'll be talking more about this in the administrative.
That's the next.
Which is the next group.
That's
so
we could
probably put this discussion off in terms of the impact of the cut and from a financial and from a work balance perspective till the next.
I do want to highlight, though, that the superintendent and assistant superintendent are basically not taking an increase in this budget. And so that also is a sacrifice. And it won't be the first time that the superintendent has done that in this district. And I think that's important.
No, that's not true.
Well, you've definitely done it before.
Yeah, that's not true.
At any rate, it shows leadership and an awareness of the severity of the situation, and I also was appreciative of it.
Yeah.
Question. Yep, Mr. Boivin.
All right, Dr. Daugherty, can we go to FY18 non-personnel reductions, please?
Yes.
Okay, PD expenses.
So I am going to go in great detail when we get to regular debt.
We will, at a high level.
No, even in a more.
My question is at a high level.
Okay.
So help us understand. We had a conversation that I think was very helpful about when I looked at the DESE codes, the standardized coding for the state, and Gail and I had a conversation, but I think it would be helpful that everybody understand what you explained to me. And that is, if you look at the data for Reading's profile as a district, you will see a number of what, on the order of $1.2 million for PD. Could you please explain at a high level, as we talked about, how that relates to these cuts and how much of that, where that money is actually going within the district, so.
I will, when we get to regular debt.
Yeah.
Okay, so
I have
how
a whole
much.
I have a whole slide on that.
Yeah. How much are you cutting here by PD expenses ballpark?
Regular day and special ed is a total of $40,000. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. And last slide, next one. So the increases in fees, I'm going to call them user fees. Parents, kids want to participate in an activity or a sport, parents have to pay more money for it. I'm using it that way. So these fees are going up. Could you remind us of two things? One is, what are the accommodations that exist, if any, for families who may be paying for multiple sports at one time? Is there a cap, number one? How does it work? And number two, is there any other mitigating factor, such as, you know, where families may not have to pay the fees at all? So you can explain that. And secondly, when you factored in these increases into the budget, did you also factor in the effect on those mitigations that families may be eligible for?
So user fees is under district-wide.
Okay.
So I would rather wait till we get to that cost center to go into detail. I will tell you that we do have things in place for families that may not be able to afford, you know, partial or full increases of user fees.
And is there a cap that
there
even if you could afford it,
cap.
You don't have to pay it?
No?
Still
no.
Have to pay, but it's
no,
less.
There's a family.
Donald
individual.
Trump still has to pay for his kids to pay all the, if his kids went to Reading, he has lots of money. You still got to pay. There's no cap. It's just all income based for your family.
No, there's a family and individual cap.
Thank you. That's what
yes,
I was.
Yes, there
asking.
Is a family and individual cap. There's also
the need based.
A separate
we need also have
based accommodation.
Based,
that's what I want to pick apart
yes.
when we get to that. So
yes.
thank you.
And that's Thursday night. We'll be talking about that in more detail.
I just want to make sure the effects of applying those, I'll call them accommodations, both the cap and the mitigation for families. I want to make sure that the effect of those is also included. So if you think on paper you're going to get X dollars, but because of these policies, you're going to get X minus Y, I want to make sure that X minus Y is what we're seeing in the budget. Thanks.
Anything else from the committee on this first?
So we're going to be able to, we're going to be able to talk about those. Fees and
yeah,
things.
So what I'm trying to do, and I'm sorry if I didn't explain it, I'm trying to start up here and funnel down, and now we're going to go into the specific cost centers. and the reductions in each cost center and the impact of the reductions in those cost centers. So you'll see that tonight for administration, you'll see that tonight for regular day.
And what may end up happening, and it's probably not a bad thing, is some repetitive conversations.
Yep.
So going over old ground, but that's good as we all wrap
sure.
our hands around this.
Yep. I'm trying to
yep.
simplify it. Okay, so the administration cost center is 2.2% of the total budget. It is the smallest cost center. It actually has been decreasing. There is a page in the budget book that shows the breakdown of each cost center. It has actually been decreasing over the last 5 years. what this cost center funds is expenses around the school committee, which includes dues to MASC, clerical, professional development expenses, the superintendent, which is the salary, clerical and FTE dues and professional development expenses. Same with the assistant superintendent. Assistant superintendent is a 0.5 FTE clerical. That person is actually used for a variety of things. The director of finance, which is the business and finance category, it's the salary. There is a payroll, 0.5 FTE, and accounts payable, which is a 1.0 FTE dues and professional development that goes along with that. Human resources, we have the salary of the interim HR administrator, a 0.5 clerical, and then the TSA for teachers, that's a contractual obligation. I believe it's $175 per teacher that chooses to be a part of that, dues and professional development expenses. And then we have our network manager, 0.3 FTE is salary is in under administration. That's really the way that DESE sets up the funding codes. So fund 0.3 of the network manager salary is in this cost center. 0.25 FTE of the data support person, which does all of the data and data reporting to DESE three times a year. The Blackboard Connect, so when we have no school, the service to and the weekly messages and things that we send out, that communication system. And then the telephone and data expenses are in this cost center. And then our labor council legal services are in this cost center. So you can see it is a, compared to all the other cost centers, it's a fairly small cost center. There are two major changes. Again, this is a decrease in this cost center. We have the cost of living adjustments, which I mentioned earlier. We do that the elimination of the school business assistant position and a decrease in labor council services. Those are the major changes that you see in this budget. The impact of the personnel reduction. So the school business assistant, when that position was filled, this person was responsible for all the budget forecasting, the grants management, the special education budgeting, and the Medicaid reimbursement. Medicaid reimbursement, and I don't know all the particulars, I know Gail and Carolyn know more, this is a revenue generation for the town. So we take in about $400,000 a year that goes back into the general fund of Medicaid reimbursement, and there's a whole bunch of different tasks and clerical pieces that need to be done, was it four times a year? And that we need to report out in order to get that funding. And if you don't report it on time, you don't get the funding. So that was a critical role of this person. That has now all been taken over, a combination of Carolyn's office, both Carolyn and the administrative assistant in special ed, and Gail. So all of the duties of that school business assistant have been taken over in that. If you look at this by object, again, each cost center is broken down into these areas. You see the professional salary increases is 0.8%. That is reflective of the salary increases for two of the district administrators in this budget, but not obviously two of them are not taking a salary increase. Your clerical salaries reflect the reduction of the position. The contract services is your labor cost decrease. And then supplies and materials are going up about $1,000. And then other expenses include dues and professional development. We do have two of our district administrators are fairly new. They both have mentors. They both have professional development expenses that go along with that. And that's why you see the increase there. We are required to provide induction for our administrators as well as our teachers. And that results in the 3.8% decrease. In staffing, you can see that there is an overall reduction of one FTE, that which was actually, as Gary pointed out, in FY17, the position was not filled. And then that is due to the administrative assistant position. So the 4.3, the 0.3 of district administrator, that's the network manager piece, the 0.3 that I mentioned earlier.
Is that Julian?
Yes, yes. I heard he helped you today. I do want to refer you to page 50. Page 50 is by detail. So this breaks down the chart I just showed you into more detail. So you can see under professional salaries, it's broken down to the administrator fees, which are the three central office administrators. The director is the HR administrator. The manager is the network manager. That's the listings of all of those salaries. The clerical salaries are the administrative assistants. You'll notice under revolving fund support that there is an offset of $40,000, which is an increase of $5,000. This is from extended day. We do support extended day, so we are allowed to take an offset from the extended day revolving account to help support the work that we do in this office, and it's to pay for the time of our administrative assistants and administrators that work with the extended day program. And then under contract services, you'll notice that the labor is decreasing. That is the biggest drop. And then supplies and materials, there are some minor increases. Even though the percentage is high, it's about $1,100. And then we have other increases. The employee benefits under other expenses is your TSA that I mentioned earlier. Professional development is, as I mentioned earlier, for our two newer district administrators. And then software and licensing, that is your Blackboard Connect and some other smaller software, which I believe includes Talent Ed. I think that's in there too. So that's the administration cost center by detail. So this is the next point that we'll take questions.
I know, there I told her. Dr. Dox, I saw her and told her 1 second. Oh, it's okay. It's okay. Yes.
Okay. I just on that TSA. So did you explain? Is that voluntary? So the teachers can choose to participate?
Yeah, it's a contractual benefit. But the teachers, I believe, if they choose to do it, it's only for teachers that were hired after, and I can't remember the date, after a certain year. And it's $175.
And what's the benefit to the teachers?
It's a tax sheltered annuity. So it goes into
a
tax tax sheltered annuity.
Okay, great.
Small number.
Yeah, it's only $175. So.
No, I mean a small number of participants.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah, it's a small number of participants.
Okay. All right, that's it for now.
So figure 35, is that the companion figure for this that gives us the FTE? So administrators.
That's the staff. Yeah. So with that chart we have up here.
Okay. And so that's administrator line in Figure 36. That's the cost for the 4.3 FTE. Am I reading that right?
The 4.3 FTE for district administrator.
Is that right?
That's the cost. Correct.
Okay. And then the administrative assistant is the 4.8.
3.8.
I'm sorry. 3.8.
Yep. 3.8.
And the PD cost, the professional development, that 15,585. In your proposal, that you said that's for two people.
It's for all of us, but the increase is the increase is due to our two renewals.
So the 4,000 extra is about 2,000 per headcount.
Yeah, and that's the mentor's support.
Are you going to speak later to what's involved in that cost, that 15,000, what we're getting for that? Or is that just the right time to ask that?
This would be the time. Or you can.
What do you get for
that?
The
could be one of the questions you can submit.
how about we? I'll do that. How's that?
Okay.
Dr. Nine.
Yeah, I still need clarity on the school business assistant. So we didn't use the funding this year. We did use the funding this year from that position.
No, we have not used the funding.
So, but that doesn't make sense to me since we hired Gail after our budget was developed last year.
Yep.
We know that previous finance director was receiving a salary that was less than what we offered Gail because of Gail's expertise and her degree. We all agreed that made sense.
We had a surplus in this cost center at the end of last year, which you approved. We did have to move some funding from this cost center. You took a vote to another cost center to fund, I think it was district-wide technology, if I recall. So there was a surplus in this cost center at the end of last fiscal year.
So I'm talking about this year's. I'm talking about that $40,000 that we're is being reduced this year, but the position's no longer there, correct?
We don't have the position.
We don't have a school business assistant.
No, we don't. We've
so
cut.
It's already been cut.
Right, but it's a position that is out of the budget now, and we had to capture that in the chart. That's what we're trying to explain to you, that it is a position that no longer exists.
It was in the fiscal 17 budget numbers, so if you're comparing the approved budget from town meeting last April to how we're rolling it to this year.
I understand that, but what I'm saying is I think Mrs. Borowski said it better than I did initially. The impact of it is maybe not as dire as 3.3
I don't think I ever used the terms dire for this position. What I'm saying is additional work responsibilities now being put on other staff members. That's all I'm saying.
So I just want this for my own clarity. Gail and Carolyn are picking up the pieces?
Gail, Carolyn, and Carolyn's administrative assistant.
I haven't finished. Or her office. Her, you just said it. So it's not specifically just Gail. It's not specifically just Carolyn. It's dispersed amongst their office.
Right, that's what I said earlier.
I just want to make sure I'm understanding it. Because it did seem initially that
the work still needs to be done, particularly the Medicaid reimbursement,
exactly,
which does bring revenue back to the town.
Understood. And you know, we hear that, you know, the additional responsibilities that are going to be placed on Gail and Carolyn. I just want it clear that there'll be additional responsibilities when you go into the regular day budget. Classroom teachers will have additional responsibilities.
I don't think anyone's disagreeing.
Okay,
with
I'm just bringing that up.
Right,
just
but I don't think anyone's disagreeing with that, Carrie.
Okay.
But in this, no teachers are taking on this responsibility. It's just one other person
in
Carolyn's group, organization.
No, there's no teachers taking on.
I mean, so these responsibilities are specifically transferred to Gail and Carolyn,
correct,
and one person that
worked
for Carolyn.
I think all Dr. Nyan's, I mean, what you're trying to say is this isn't happening now. It's been so you've already taken on these responsibilities. And with maybe the hope that we would have been able to hire someone, now we're saying it's...
No, we made a conscious effort not to fill this position.
No, I know.
Yeah.
I know you, but you, at this time last year when the position wasn't filled yet or whenever it became empty, we were planning on filling it at that point.
We were, yes, that is correct.
So what you were doing was an interim type responsibility. What now is no longer interim, it's part of your job.
Don't forget, she wasn't here last year.
I'm just saying it's now part of the job description as opposed to other duties as assigned or whatever.
If I could just come, I mean, I think I would agree with your point, though, that if the metric that we used with our leadership team was to see, you know, what would have the most or least impact on student outcomes, this was not one that we were agonizing over.
Yeah, no, this wasn't.
because it was something that we were kind of anticipating was probably the direction we needed to go. You're right that other positions over the last 2 months, we were really looking at the K-12 sort of vertical alignment. How would a cut here make an impact? How would a cut here? So, I mean, yes, of all of them, this was not one that caused the agony that some of the other discussions did. Absolutely.
Yeah, exactly. That was, thank you.
Yes, absolutely. Mrs. Perry.
Just for clarification, for revolving fund support, you mentioned extended day. Is it only extended day to get revolving fund?
For this budget,
correct.
Yes.
Because it does seem like some of the other revolving funds are still supporting those functions. You don't get any relief?
We do. You'll see when we go through some of the others, the majority of it is the reason for extended day is because we are assisting with their payroll, with accounts payable, with a lot of the day-to-day finance activity. So that's how we're doing that one. But a lot of the other revolving accounts aren't necessarily as discrete as that payroll. I would look at it. We do it for the districts, all of the schools. So that's already part. I wouldn't take money out of a revolving account for that, but extended day, since they're their own, for lack of a better term, entity.
Yeah.
We look at that differently.
We took them from other ones too, because you are supporting them and resourcing to get called for doing it. Just didn't realize that.
I think not to the extent that
yep.
the extended day one, but
so
as
you
we
have
go
to be
through.
Really crisp about
it's not as, you can't draw that direct line, which is what we need to make sure we can.
In figure 36 and figure 35, the amount per administrative assistant budgeted salary, one is listed as 214,243 and one is listed as 217,061. It looks like they should be the same.
Yeah,
I
know one of
the district administrator numbers are the same.
Page 47 and 50.
Yeah, it's up by 3,000 is what you said.
Yeah.
Where are we?
Yeah, 47.
Do we know which one's correct?
So this is based off of base salaries. We do build into here if there are administrative assistants that might have overtime hours based upon what they're doing is based on the total salary. So we can update this chart to pull it. And one of them's contracted salary. Their base salary, and then within the district wide, there is some additional time for administrative assistants that work to do school committee meetings and such at that. So we want to make sure we capture the additional hours that they may work to cover the meetings.
Thanks.
So that's what that slight difference is.
Yeah, that's just their base salary.
Yes, that's the base salary is what figure 35 is.
So this here, the detail one is the one that you probably
is slightly higher due
yeah,
to
that's
capturing
to
some of the overtime hours. Right. That would be above and beyond their contracted base salaries.
Thank you. Okay. Move on
regular
to regular day.
Okay, so regular day, this is the one that we're going to go into a lot of detail, so bear with us. Regular day is approximately 60% of the total budget. This is what all of the areas that regular day funds, you can see here that you have all of your building administrators, secretaries, teachers, tutors, regular education, paraprofessionals, your school psychologists, your guidance counselors, English language learner, teachers, instructional specialists, any teacher mentor or curriculum leadership stipends are in this cost center. All of your curriculum materials, your professional development, substitute teachers, and substitute paraprofessionals, the mandatory student transportation that's not special ed specific, or athletics. all of your instructional materials and supplies, instructional technology, not network technology, that's under another cost center, any library materials and any testing and assessment software materials. All of these things are funded in regular day, which is why it's the largest part of the budget. So here are the major changes in this cost center. It's this includes all of the salary and benefit obligations that I had mentioned earlier. It does level fund, and I'm going to show you a slide later to this. It level funds the building level funds from FY17. What it does is we've redistributed the funds, and I'll show you a chart that gets into that. There are several positions that are reduced from this cost center. So you have 3.3 FTE kindergarten paraeducators, 2 elementary classroom teachers, 7 middle school, 3.8 high school classroom teachers, the instructional coach. You have professional development expenses in regular day. And then you have the decreases in the 2 offsets that I mentioned earlier, $40,000 for the METCO grant and $50,000 for full-day kindergarten. And as I mentioned earlier, it does not include additional funding for the multi-year science. So I'm going to start going over the impact of the personnel reductions. I'll go one at a time. So first of all, the regular education paraeducators, this is in kindergarten. So prior to 2013, well, I should say currently we have full-time kindergarten paraeducators in all of our kindergarten classrooms, regardless of full day or half day. Prior to 2013, the amount of hours in each kindergarten were 19 hours for full day kindergarten and 12 and a half hours for half day kindergarten. So we are going back to pre-2013 levels when that was the amount of hours allocated to each kindergarten classroom. The elementary classroom teachers, there's going to be a reduction of 2. This is going to cause an increase in class sizes in some grade through 3 to 5 classroom to 25 to 27 students. That will depend solely on class size throughout the district. One of the variables that we need to keep an eye on is kindergarten, incoming kindergarten enrollment, to see if there's any shift of teaching staff there, which could have an impact on this reduction. So that's something we need to keep an eye on. We're still looking at our kindergarten half day and full day numbers and how that's going to play out. And hopefully by the end of the month, we'll have a better idea of pretty much what the kindergarten enrollment will be within, 10 to 20%. The middle school classroom, the middle school piece is going to take a couple minutes, so bear with me. So currently in the middle school, we have a 7 period day. And what we are going to have to do with this restructuring to maintain the middle school interdisciplinary model piece, which is something that we feel is we need to keep in the best interest of the students, we're going to go from a 7 period day to a 6 period day. In order to go to a 6 period day, we are going to need to cut 1 core subject out of each grade. It needs to be a reduction from each grade in order to, so that the schedule can continue to provide the support and team structure and planning time, common planning time for the teachers to meet and have ownership in for those 100 students that they teach. We are also going to have to do some restructuring of our specialist schedules, our art, music, and other specialist schedules to be able to accommodate the schedule change. The 2 middle school principals have been working on the schedule for the last several weeks and are continuing to do that. So how are we going to make this work? Currently in the 6th grade, there are 2 periods of English language arts. That will be reduced to 1 period of English language arts each day for students. So you're going a reduction from 2 to 1. In 7th grade, it will be the elimination of foreign language. In grade 8, foreign language is going to become an elective. It will not be required for students. So students will choose foreign language. There will also be a selection process if there are more students than what the staffing will allow. In this model, there will be about 200 students that will be taking foreign language out of approximately 300, 310 students. mathematics will become part of the interdisciplinary team. Right now it's off team. And so because you now no longer have five subjects, you have four core subjects. The changes, as I mentioned earlier, will maintain the middle school model. So that's, those are all the impacts of the middle school piece. In terms of the high school, the reductions are include a 0.8 FTE art, a 0.6 FTE business, a 1.0 FTE physical education, and a 1.4 FTE science, social studies, and English language arts. With this, we will have to suspend the fine arts and business requirements for the incoming freshman class, the class of 2021. It doesn't mean they cannot take fine arts and business classes. They certainly can. But given the uncertainty at this point, we don't want to make a requirement of something we don't know if we can move forward on. There will be higher class sizes in art, business, and physical education. We will see an elimination of the college prep level classes in science, social studies, English language arts. So there are three levels at the high school. For those of you that may not have children at the high school, we have the honors level, we have the strong college prep level, we have the college prep level. College prep level has the lowest class sizes. So what we will be doing is we will be having an integration of the strong college prep and the college prep level. And there will be adequate special education support if there was that support earlier. There will also be higher class sizes as a result in the strong college prep and honors classes as a result of that. The instructional coach is the mathematics instructional coach. So what this means, as you saw from the presentation the other night, this is a person that is working very closely with teachers to provide that coaching support in the classroom. For grades K to 5, we're continuing to transition to a more rigorous math curriculum. Person is modeling lessons for teachers, helping with the transition as we're moving to common assessments. All of those things are being put in place right now at the K to 5 level. So indirectly, that may have an impact on the pace of the transition that we're going through. And this is a professional development piece. If you remember, this position was created not by additional funds, but from a restructuring of professional development funds a few years ago, or 2 years ago, I believe. So if you take a look at the cost center by object, the professional salary piece is not showing an increase, and that is a combination of the contractual increases that are in here, but the reductions that are occurring as well. Your clerical salaries and other salaries are going up, and that's more contractual. The other salaries is an increase in the substitute teacher line item to be more reflective of the historical, what we're seeing across the board. Your contract services, that is the bus transportation that is increasing. Supplies and materials, and the other expenses, those are primarily increases from the building budgets. I'm going to go into that in a little bit more detail in the next couple of slides. So overall, the regular day is going up 0.5%. And here is the staffing piece of regular day. And there's so what I just said earlier about the reductions in FTEs are captured here throughout this chart. So you see reductions with the high school, you see reductions at middle school, you see reductions at the elementary. So I want to talk a little bit about building-based budgets, because there was some confusion last year about building-based budgets. So I hope that after tonight, we'll have a better understanding of building-based budget. So each school is allocated an amount of funds to operate the day-to-day activities of the school. The funding is based on the October 1st enrollment from the previous year as we're developing the budget. It's a per pupil amount. And we did level fund FY18 from FY17. If you recall, a few years ago, we actually decreased this. But we said that this was a one-time decrease that we had to increase again the following year. We did not feel we could decrease this based on the increase in expenses that have occurred at the elementary and middle school level, particularly with science. So one of the questions last year is, you know, how are we going to be able to fund the consumable piece of No Atom Science and the other science pieces moving forward, is because we're reallocating the per pupil across the three levels. So I'm gonna show you that. So building-based budgets fund the following. All the building supplies for the office in that school and the classrooms, text materials and consumables, classroom furniture, classroom equipment and technology, art and physical education materials and supplies, paper, copier leases, memberships and dues, any instructional software, and ongoing software licenses, testing supplies, any conferences, workshops, or professional development that may be at the building level, and graduation expenses for the high school. That is all in your building-based budgets. This is how it's calculated. You can see the FY17 per pupil value, which is the current year. And the total, you can see how we calculated the FY18 per pupil value. So you can see that we have essentially leveled the funding across the grade levels, the building levels. So elementary is now seeing an increase in their per pupil value, going from 152 to 161. The middle school has gone from 152 to 157, and the high school has gone from 175 to 163. And that, again, is because of the increases that we saw at the middle and elementary level with expenses, most particularly the science supplies. So if we go to pages 54 and 55, I wanted to go into a little bit more detail. So what I just referred to in the building-based budgets are found in two categories, supplies and materials. So if you go down on page 54, the supplies and you hit the supplies and materials, you see all of those categories, art, business, curriculum, elementary, curriculum, high school. All of those is the building-based expenses. Very little comes from the district level in that piece. That's all the building-based budgets. And then if you flip to page 55, you also see other out of other expenses. Those are also building-based expenses. There is some district expenses mixed in, but there are building-based expenses in here as well. So these are the line items that you see the most fluctuation in your budget book each year, because it really is based on the needs of each building, and the building principals put these budgets together. So one year they may not need as much paper. They may not need as, or the copier leases go down, or you know, they may not need as much art supplies. So you will see fluctuations in different line items. You'll notice under supplies and materials that there is an increase, and I just need to find it. Oh yeah, consumables, where is it? Oh, next page, I'm sorry. You look at workbooks and consumables, which is on page 55. That is an increase because of the No Atom Science. And you'll also, if you go up to science on the same page, you'll also see a significant increase there. So a lot of the elementary increase in their per pupil went to these two line items because of the consumable increase of the No Atom Science. And so this is what you're seeing in these two categories are the building-based expenses of the eight schools. So I want to now move to professional development. So one of the line items that you see here, on page 55, is professional development. So I want to kind of outline what makes up some of the expenses in professional development. And some of these are in that line item, and some of them are in other parts of the detailed budget. So tuition reimbursement is under the category of professional development. That is a contractual obligation. Curriculum leader stipends, teacher mentor stipends, and stipends for PD work, those are all in the contract in the collective bargaining agreement for teachers. You also have smaller amounts in, under conference workshops, PD expenses for general education, and PD materials. The district-wide PD, you could see, has an amount of about $50,000. That is the amount that is allocated for curriculum work during the summer, curriculum work during the school year, maybe some workshops that are provided for teachers during either the school year or during the summer. You can see that has come down significantly over the last few years. One of the reasons is we restructured a part of that funding for the instructional coaches in FY, looks like 14, I'm sorry, 15. So this number has been decreasing over time. Going to the next slide, which I believe is what Mr. Boyman was talking about earlier. So in the budget book, and I don't know the exact page, there is a number that is part of a DESE category called professional development. And it shows in the FY15 actual, which is the latest state data that we have, is that we spend $1.1 million in professional development. Well, this is how it's broken down. Because a DESE category is a very broad category that's used for the end of the year report. The bulk of that $1.1 million is what is called staff professional development days. So teachers have a 185-day contract. 180 days is with students, 5 days is without students. Those 5 days are called professional days. There are two before the school year. There's one that's a conference day, and then there's one in March, and then there's one, another one in November we had this year. The salaries of those 5 days for all teachers goes in that line item, which makes up part, which you can see is $701,000 in FY15. So we do not spend $1.1 million on curriculum work or workshops. That is the 5 days of contractual salaries for the 5 days that teachers have for professional development in the school calendar. You can see also that there are tuition reimbursement is in here, all of the stipends that are in the collective bargaining agreement. There's some other things, teacher induction supplies, the district-wide professional development work. What we also wanted to show you is, although this is not the official DESE category, Gail put together what the FY18 recommended budget is for this same DESE category if we were doing that end of the year report today, and that this was the approved budget. And so you could see that the staff professional development days have gone up because we've had salary increases since FY15. You could see that the district-wide PD category has gone down, as I showed you in the last slide. Tuition reimbursement, which is contractual, the substitute coverage has gone up a little bit, and the stipends have gone up a little bit. Again, that's contractual, and then supplies have actually gone down. So that's how you come up with that number of $1.1 million, which is in the budget book. So in essence, the only amount that is put aside for curriculum work or workshops is the $50,000 in FY18.
We had a quick question on this slide.
Where's 16 and 17?
The we utilized the end of year report from DESE to pull the FY15 numbers. The 16 and 17 are not available yet.
Yeah, we just wanted to show you what it would be in 18 with the recommended budget. But 15 is, that's the last state data we have.
Okay.
The other chart had.
We can't find that in our own numbers.
We can do our own numbers, yes.
Oh, I want to know. I mean, that goes back, we're going back three, not tonight, but it's something, we're going back 3 years.
We could certainly do that. I was trying, what I was trying to, the main reason to show you this slide was to show you where the bulk of the funds were coming from, because I think there's this misperception in the community that we spend $1.1 million on professional development. According to DESE, we do, but that's not, you know, what we've been using, you know, our definition of it.
Can you show the previous slide, though?
Oh, wait 1 second. Are you coming to questions? Was that, I just want to let you finish up before
yeah,
we do.
So.
Okay. So we're good to go with questions?
Yeah, we can go with questions.
All right. 1 second. Mr. Blavin had one.
Oh, it was attached to Chuck's. That's the only reason.
Okay, go ahead.
Same, why don't you go ahead?
So this is because it's the specific DESE categories, but this slide is like our budget.
This
categories.
Is our budget, correct.
So we have 14, 15, 16.
And the only reason for the DESE one is we can definitely pull it together. It's just a line item by line item calculation to go through, and we wanted to address questions that Nick as well as the public had, so we wanted to use
the DESE
the
number.
Latest DESE
okay.
number that people had seen, and then to show if we were to fast forward it, what it would look like now in the essence of being able to provide information.
Yeah, but so to Mr. Robinson's point, can you manipulate the FY16 data? And okay, I just wanted to make sure. I was just trying to make sure that I wasn't misreading these two charts. The categories are similar.
Mm-hmm.
They're
similar.
Some of them, okay. The easiest. One of them is more of a pure play where it's really just this is exactly what you recorded on the general ledger, where the other one it's more going in and reallocating salaries. It's sliced.
You have to drill down.
You have to drill down and do calculations that aren't necessarily within the financial reporting application because it's purely a DESE allocation.
Okay.
So we can absolutely do that.
I just have one other on this chart. So there's nothing. We just can't do anything about it this year. The loss of the math instructional coach is really, it's sort of a double whammy then because we eliminated the district-wide PD, right? It was previously like, say, 130,000 in FY15, if that's sort of where we made that switch. Mm-hmm. And we said, okay, we're not gonna provide teachers with that professional development because we're gonna provide this instructional coach. And something which our district has been working to do since my 23-year-olds were in third grade. So it's not really a double whammy when we're losing this math coach. And what we've heard over the last few months when we've listened on the literacy and the math and Joshua Eaton, we've heard a lot about programs, and what was the math thing, math access,
the assessment
program, which, you know, certainly sound like they're the right direction to move in, but the combination of eliminating the math coach and, you know, paras is certainly not going to help us really move forward with that, but I don't have for you an idea right now of where you can cut another $60,000 or $70,000 and keep the math coach, so maybe we'll work on that.
Mr. Blavin's been waiting very patiently.
Figure 13 is the per pupil by category FY15 number to Chuck's
budget.
What page?
From the
it's the
budget book. It's also in the handout that everyone has.
Oh.
Yep. Okay.
Okay, so I just want to make sure I understand one quick thing here. So I'm comparing that number, and I want to ask whether there's something we're not counting here. Okay. So under PD in figure 13, we see $1.188 million.
Right. That's the
right.
FY15 number.
Right. And that jives with the number in your slide, first column, bottom row, right? Then after that, you see the 190,000 that comes in after that in grants. So my question is there grant money that's here that's not shown on this slide in the FY18 since there was in 15, and how much is that?
There, the charts are similar. I can pull, I looked at just the general fund since that's what we were looking at for the proposed budget. I can include the grant funded piece on here.
Is it a half a million? Is it 10K? Is
it stays pretty consistent.
190?
Some of this may be the school transformation grant. I believe that was the first year of the grant. So that's, there is a lot of professional development in that grant. Title IIA is another professional development grant.
So the question is, are we just getting a comparable boost this year to the 18 budget that you saw in 15? So in 2015, you had about 200K that came in grants. And my question is, are we getting another 200K in 18 that's not reflected here?
No, that number's probably lower.
Right, I think.
Yeah, that number's lower.
So that could be a good follow-up. Then if you flip to figure 15, well, actually, page 29, which comes after, there's a nice breakdown, I think, of the PD. I don't think we need to go through that. I just think it's a nice companion to the chart you just showed.
You actually prompted me to put that in there.
It's terrific. It's wonderful. Wonderful. You're miraculously responsive, as I've said before. The figure 15 is the last point I wanted to comment on. So figure 15 is a ranking of the schools we've selected as comparable districts or comparable towns.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to note, so according to this, we have like a ranking and a per pupil amount in this, right? So we have total district and then rank among these, what, dozen, 13 schools, is that it?
It's 13, correct.
Yeah, so we're number one in PD. We got 315 per student there for Reading, right? And then, you know, we're numbers 3, 12, 8, and 10 in these other categories. So I guess my question is, when we say we're $315 per student, we're number one in the ranking among these schools for professional development, is that apples to apples? Meaning, are they calculating their professional development the same way we're calculating it?
They are. I think the big difference is that we have 5 days for professional development.
Okay.
Most districts have less than five. Some have two, some have three. I think that's the biggest difference. So if you take the salaries for the school district, I think there's your difference. That's why we're probably number one out of the 13. My guess is, and I don't know this for a fact, my guess is that these other communities do not have five professional days.
So not just the ranking, but the absolute value strikes me. We're six times what Hingham is. Six times what Hingham spends on PD. Does that sound right to you? That's what the number says. Again, that's why I asked the apples to apples question, right? I mean, they say $54 per student, and we're at $315 per student. That sounds right to you? I mean, that's what the numbers say. But
I do think a big part of it is the, because your biggest chunk of that $1.1 million is your teacher salaries.
Okay.
So I don't know how many professional days Hingham has, but I bet that's the difference.
I think that's the difference.
And this is completely anecdotal, so take it for that, but when I first joined the committee 3 years ago, the first time that I went through the calendar approval process where we were going to vote on the calendar, I on my own did a Google search of peer districts and certainly was struck that very few districts have 186 school days. So that was 3 years ago.
Have?
Much lower, 182.
Yeah, they have to, it has to be 180
by law. Right?
Oh, sorry, yeah. I'm sorry. What did
right.
I
so most are probably 182, 183.
And we have 185.
Mm-hmm.
We have
185.
Yeah.
180 plus the five.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. Yeah, Mr.
I think maybe, and correct me, Doctor, if I'm wrong, but I guess if these are FY15 figures in that ranking, I'm assuming that status has changed, for instance, even with the coaches. So, as was mentioned, we reallocated PD funding to coaches, partly because research shows that's a much more effective way to offer support to teachers. Some of the districts that get the biggest bang for their buck do it that way, but it also changes.
Yeah, coaching is not part of this.
Where it's captured. So, for instance, if other districts have coaches, which they do, they're not seen in this particular figure. And now ours isn't either. But in FY15, the funding is listed there.
I know that a lot of districts have a lot more coaching.
That's what I'm saying.
These numbers we're looking at are 2 years ago.
Right. Just glancing at this, it's at least 60,000, which is would move the needle.
One last question. How did you reallocate? How did you do that?
the professional, the PD funding that we had, that line item that's now 50,000, that was higher, so we restructured that fund, those to the positions.
But did you do that within the each of the units? So if you have a special ed PD budget and you have a general regular day
so
budget?
From the district general PD funds, we just, so instead
in regular
of
day.
Within regular
making
day
that discretionary PD, we are going to fund the salaries of coaches.
Thank you.
And just to be clear, we did that through the annual budget process.
Right.
So Dr. Dougherty
right.
came
that
to us.
That was a recommendation
it
we
was
made.
A strategic decision to do professional development differently. Here's how we propose we pay for it. So the school committee approved that.
Thank you.
Sure.
I just had a question about the per pupil reallocation and high school.
You talking about the building budget?
Yeah, the building budgets.
Yep.
So that's a pretty big reduction for the high school building budget, and I just wanted to understand if the any of the services that like guidance provides around the whole college search and destroy mission for students was impacted by that, and also with the if there's graduation pieces that
graduation is built in.
Okay, so will seniors be paying a lot more for out of their pockets?
I will defer to Mr. Bachman.
So we're looking at a model where right now the dues just cover very, very minimum costs. I think it's about $25 at the end of the year, and then capping down is an additional expense. So just having students, seniors pick up a little bit more than that tab between about $125 and $100 just to help defray the cost would reduce some of that budget to see absorbed in that per pupil.
So what kind of increase would they see?
I think last year it was 50-55, so this would go up to 100-125. We're still negotiating with the vendor, particularly with the graduation caps.
Again. It's the caps and gowns and those expenses.
If you could go back to the professional development one, I just have a question. On the so there's two sides, there's the professional development breakdown in FY18 budget and then professional breakdown by the DESE category. And I apologize if this was already answered, but requested budget for FY18 for district-wide PD is $49,350, right?
Yep.
Then I go to the next side and it says district-wide professional development, workshops, curriculum work. The recommended is $65,150, and I know it's small.
There's other things in this one that are not.
This is the apples and oranges.
Yeah,
okay.
That are not in that one.
Okay, thanks. Answers that.
We're sorry that DESE's.
It was a small difference,
yeah.
I just wanted to know. Now we can go back to the building base.
Oh.
Building base.
Oh, building base, yep.
Mm-hmm. So I understand that there's been a. We're not changing the overall amount we give to the principals, but we're shifting who gets what for curriculum reasons. How has this amount changed over time? So the amount that we allocate to principals every year?
That's a good question. I would rather than answer it, we'll get you the information.
That'd be great to see.
It has gone up and it's gone down because of budget cut years. We have twice done it as a one-time reduction over, like, say, 6 years, and then brought it back up to the levels again. But we'll get you the exact information.
And it could change year over year, elementary, middle,
yep.
High school. So it
I'm a little bit more interested in the bottom line number because I imagine it would change.
Oh, you're talking about
oh,
the full amount.
The full?
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yep. Although the other, it's probably interesting to get the other two.
We can definitely
can.
Get
yep.
you that information.
Yeah. Let's grab
it. On this, and you may have said it, I was reading through stuff.
No, it's okay.
I guess I'm struggling with that most of the pain is being absorbed by the RMHS here in terms of, I think Mr. Barker just mentioned the cost of caps and gowns. I mean, how did we come up with them going down significantly and everybody else going up?
The elementary particularly, but middle school to an extent also, has become over time a very heavy consumable budget, which requires more funding. High school doesn't have as much consumable. They don't have workbooks, they don't have those types of things that you have to buy year after year. They have durable goods, they have other supplies and materials they have to buy. We're not saying that the high school doesn't need that funding. We're saying we had a long discussion about this as a district leadership team. And what we were trying to do was to keep this level funded, given all of the other decisions that we were making in the budget. And that's so the only way that we could make sure that the NOADM was funded at the same time that we were keeping level funded, you know, the bottom line, is that we reallocated the funds. And again, I'll defer to Mr. Barker as the in terms of the impact. You know, one of the other things that we talked about it dealt with technology. And one of the things that we still have in our budget is there is $100,000 in there that's for technology replacement. And in the past, that was more of a shared responsibility between schools and the district. Now, because of this shift, it's going to have to be more in the burden of the district when we have technology replacement. And that is an area that the high school did have a lot of funding in the past as part of their per pupil. So now that's a shift that's going to have to happen. With that $100,000 is going to have to be used more solely as the only replacement line item we have, which is another reason why we didn't reduce that.
I guess I'm just, and again, I'm thinking globally as we go through the next few days, we're going to be potentially asking for an athletic fee increase. And it's kind of hidden here, but we're also going to be asking for the seniors now to pay more for their caps and gowns, plus if they play a sport. So we just, that's all. I mean, maybe we can't solve that tonight.
Right.
I understand. Maybe look at a way of spreading it around differently. I don't know.
So thinking about the NEASC evaluation that's upcoming and the suspension of some graduation requirements, we perceive that as a problem. Is that something, I know I've served on a NEASC team and I know they do look at your requirements, fine arts, and there's a value judgment, I think, placed on those.
I'll defer again to Mr. Barker, who's...
Yeah, and we'll still continue to offer all those electives. We'll just be consistent with NASCOR, making sure that the students took all of NASCOR requirements, and continue to offer phys ed, NASCOR for that as well. But it just will be that the double, the 2 years of business, the 2 years of arts, or the two semesters of art, that we would just put on hold for the incoming freshmen. And so that wouldn't, it shouldn't, impact accreditation, but we certainly can reach out to the director to make sure.
So if they're suspended, are they all going to? If let's say if you're a freshman, will they be able to take an art class, a music class?
Yes, absolutely.
They will not be shut out.
No.
Okay. Just well, they will not be required to take, like, you know. So there's a 2-semester requirement now. They won't be required either semester. They just, it's an elective strictly.
Right. So currently it's 2 semesters of art, 2 semesters of business. Those are no longer for the short term anyways being part of the requirement to graduate, starting the incoming class. But they certainly could still take them if their schedule allowed. We would still encourage kids to have a busy schedule, you know, no more than one directed study in an incoming freshman schedule, unless there were some real extreme circumstances. And so we would just anticipate the class sizes would increase as a result of the reduction, but we should still be able to provide them for all the students who are interested.
And all students will have physical education every year?
Yes. And so again, that'll be a place where we would see some class size increases. Joe Kane, one of our in-house registrar scheduler, just kind of ran the numbers and currently the averages are in phys ed ranging from 21 to 25, and he anticipates it kind of running a mock schedule, that those numbers would bump up a little bit from the mid-20s to the high 20s. So you would see an increase, but we would still be able to run those so that all students are able to get, satisfy the PE requirement.
How many students do we have at the high school now?
It's 12-7.
It's right over there, 12-7.
So I did the math. It comes out to like 30, but 31, just, you know, comparable, I guess, but I just thought I'd mention that. And then the, I guess that's basically it for the high school. Can I ask another question?
Yeah, sure.
So the one I really have a lot of problem with, particularly after the last school committee meeting, was the two, the 3.3 paraprofessional personnel at the kindergarten level, because, you know, specifically, I'm not sure why. I would imagine you increased them back in 2013 for this very reason, that the expectations of kindergarten students, the performance level is much greater than it was previous years. And the way they are taught, as we've heard, is in centers, so to speak, and kindergartners aren't independent learners. Mm-hmm. So having a paraprofessional there on an ongoing basis on a regular day, I think is critical. I would hate to be that kindergarten teacher trying to figure out what to do with, you know, 3/5 of the class, or 4/5 of the class, where I worked with one other fifth, or even when they were talking about doing the math literacy.
Assessment. Yep.
And I don't know, do they do dibbles? They don't do dibbles, do they? They do. Okay. So I would just like to have us think about, you know, I know it's not easy, but think about those cuts really being absorbed somewhere else, because I just think they're critical. And I think the elementary class size, you said it will go, they won't average 27 grades 3 through 5.
No, there'll be the classes that are affected, it won't be every grade 3 to 5 classroom. The classes that will be affected could go up to 25 to 27.
And right now we have some at 25, but.
Correct, yep.
And then again, we all, you know, I'm just stating the obvious that, you know, 3 or 4 more students is a lot more work for an elementary classroom teacher. And I just think, again, the significance of the cuts are really important. I know maybe not agreed by every school committee member, but I just think that you look at a $40,000 cut in administration and then these gigantic cuts, I think, at elementary level, I don't know. I think people were expecting a greater administrative cut. I don't know how people feel here, but that was the sense I was getting from the community. I'm not saying I have a solution to it. I'm just saying that's.
I completely understand what you're saying, Gary. As I said, we went through several renditions of budget and struggled with all of them, and as I said to staff and budget parents when I've been talking to them, we have to open up next year with the supports necessary for the teachers that are going to be here, the materials, supplies, the administrative support, the clerical support, because the teachers that will be here next year, they're going to need to be supported. And so we had to balance all of those things. And as you know, because you worked in Reading, we don't have a lot of administrators in this district. And we have principals, we have some assistant principals, there aren't a lot of administrators. So if you remove one of those administrators from buildings, or if you remove clerical support from those buildings, you're giving the clerical support to the administrators to do, because it's still got to get done. And when there are student issues, they still have to be addressed by administrators.
Yeah, I understand that.
I mean, so.
I understand that. Don't get me wrong, as you
no,
said.
No, I, so,
I've
I mean,
been here
we
a long
had,
time, I know.
Those are the discussions we've been having.
And, you know, we've had, there were years where we didn't have a human resource director, we did not have a finance director, was shared by the town. And I'm not saying that we should do that necessarily. I think what we have in place makes sense, but I'm just saying that's a perspective that I think a lot of people have.
No, I understand that. A lot of things have happened in laws and regulations since the days when Richard Foley was doing the budget work for the town.
Another, I guess, another question too is, you're not gonna replace the department head in physical education, so.
No, we are.
Oh, you are?
Yeah, that's still in, that's still in place, yep.
Who would that be?
I think that's.
We don't know.
Would be a teacher or?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I thought you wanted to.
I don't wanna know.
Yeah.
We don't do that.
No, no.
I just didn't wanna see it.
No, the department.
I didn't want the athletic director to have to take.
No, the department head stipend is still in there.
Okay.
Still in the budget.
I know a couple people have their hands up, and I definitely want to have an opportunity for the public to speak, but I would like the committee to kind of finish their questions, so that's why I'm not ignoring you, I'm just putting you on hold. Dr. Doxson.
I had a couple of questions. I'm hearing about the higher class sizes, and I appreciate how that's a compromise that is unwanted, but an unfortunate result of what the cuts are going to bring. I'm just wondering about, I know we have space issues too, I'm wondering about the space for these additional numbers in our classrooms. And in particular, there was a discussion about the high 20s for the size of the PE classes. And I know that oftentimes PE classes are in the field house at the same time. And so I just was wondering about the dynamics of that and the that was one of my questions. And then the second one, well, maybe I'll let you address that first, and then I'll ask my second question.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be a challenge that we have to prepare for. We've already begun early conversations with our department heads. But with phys ed, because it's a shared space, it's still a challenge, but it's a little bit easier to absorb. Because you have more than one person in the facility at a time, so we'll just have to schedule accordingly, knowing that it's far less than ideal.
Thank you.
If I can just
the square footage of the classrooms at the high school are around 900 square feet, which are very similar to the square footage of classrooms in other schools in the district, which have had class sizes of 27, 28. I'm not saying it's optimum, but it has.
It'll fit the desks. And
it has happened. It has happened already.
Quick comment, just to support.
Yeah.
Can I just?
Yeah, she had a second question,
okay.
So we'll come back.
Oh, I'm
to
sorry.
Go ahead, Dr. Doxson.
My second sort of comment question is, my heart's just breaking about the language in the middle school. And I know I've said this a million times, and I understand how much has been done to try to, and I feel listened to, because I feel like it's not as extreme as it could have been. But I feel part of my passion for the language is because our kids need to know this is not the only place in the world. This is not the only way things have been done. This is not the only language that's spoken, and language uses different parts of the brain that I think are really important to exercise. And until kids, and I think it should happen in elementary myself, but until kids experience that, they don't really know they might have a passion in language and a skill and passion in language. One of my question is about the impact taking language or it's not being taken out of middle school, but compromising and making it an elective in eighth grade. What kind of an impact is that going to have on their learning languages in high school? Are they still going to be able to catch up and fulfill a graduation requirement and any kind of fluency going on in their lives, not just college, but in their lives?
So that was a multi-part question.
It was. I always ask
so,
multi-part.
Foreign language is not disappearing at the middle school. It will be a full year course. And there'll be a transition year because
our current seventh graders have taken the equivalent of a half a year. So eventually it will become a full year course in eighth grade for those students that are choosing it. It's an elective, but there will be over 200 students taking foreign language still at middle school. That will still allow them to continue to move forward, and if they choose, to go all the way to AP, just like they do now. So most colleges require 3 years of a foreign language. State colleges require 2 years of a foreign language. So we're not denying anyone the access to foreign language courses in order to be able to, for their requirements for college admission. I'm not agreeing, you know, I'm not saying that these are optimum things that I'm saying, but it, the options are still there for students to take foreign language.
I understand that. Part of my question is about when the kids that have, those kids that didn't have it as an elective in eighth grade, they hit ninth grade and they're starting the language for the first time because it's still a requirement. So I'm interested in what the teachers feel about how that's going to impact their learning and what that does to the curriculum and their...
It's going to have an impact, yeah. But we do have students now that take a first year of a language as a freshman, whether it be Latin, whether it be French one. Well, French, not as much, but Spanish one. We do have students that take Spanish one. So it does happen now. Again, we're not, it's not optimum, but they do have the ability to still take foreign language.
And just a personal note, I do know that my son started Spanish. He had French, and he started Spanish in ninth grade and flew with it. He loved it. So I know it's not a permanent handicap not to be able to have it in middle school. I just...
And you will see changes of what is offered in ninth grade as a result of this change also, yes.
Will we still be able to continue the exchange programs and those, will the kids still have the skills come sophomore, junior year?
There's been no, you know, indication that that would not continue, but, you know, obviously that, those are discussions that would have to happen.
I promise, Dr. Knight.
But can I say one more, when, you know, and I've said, people who have heard me in multiple venues talk about the budget reductions know how I feel about this, but some of the things we're talking about are things that we were doing in the 90s. You know, we had foreign language at the middle school as an elective for eighth grade only in the 90s. So this is not, and it's not something that we are enjoying moving forward, back, moving backwards. But it was a full year course. It was the equivalent of a Spanish one or French one course. I am sure that the skill level may not have been the same as it is for the kids that are doing it now. But these are courses that we did offer in the way that they're going to be offered next year if we move forward with this, as we did in the 90s.
I just don't like it.
Again, I'm not, everything I'm saying is not something I'm advocating for. I'm just saying that it has happened, unfortunately, in the past.
Yeah, and I think that's a really good point. Nobody think that these are good things.
Right.
At all.
I need to keep saying it because I don't want to sound like I'm advocating for any of the things we're talking about.
And I think I think your point is well taken, that when you say, well, I don't want to make that cut, well, we have to look somewhere else then, because we have to live within our means. There is no more money out there. Dr. Nine.
Just to respond to Dr. Dox's concern about space for physical education. You've got multiple teaching stations. You've got the fitness center and the gym floor and the challenge course, so you should be okay in that regard. The one thing I did mention, I think, to Samat and Dr. Daugherty in our individual meetings, Elaine and I were there, is, you know, just a way, maybe a creative approach to maintaining the foreign language would be to look at trimesters as opposed to semesters. That to me, I would envision, you know, seventh graders having a trimester as opposed to a semester. granted, not as much time and probably not obviously as beneficial, but nonetheless, it's better than nothing, you know. And I don't know if it would impact other areas that would, you know, I wouldn't know that, but.
Well, you know, we certainly can look at it. There's a lot of, the schedule's being put together, and unfortunately, we're constrained with a lot of the staffing that is available for the middle school schedule.
I'm just throwing it out. I just, you know, seen it work before with the districts.
Mrs. Webb, are you waiting?
Yeah, yes, thank you. So I just want to say that I appreciate where we are with the language piece, because I think a month or 2 months ago, or whatever, whenever we started all this, it might have looked like that was just not going to be possible at all. So I appreciate that. And I have a question about, I was looking at page 52, the regular day staffing, and one of the questions that came to mind was some of the additional resources that were talked about by Joshua Eaton when Eric presented to us. You know, there's been some sort of additions or adjustments to support Eaton, and I just was wondering, are those all?
That's in special ed.
Okay, that was all
so
in special ed.
So yeah, those
okay.
That was special ed staff.
Okay, and then in terms of the class size, I think that given that this is the most dramatic set of budget cuts that we've had, I think, since the 90s.
Yep.
That the fact that it's looking like we'll be able to hopefully stay within the guidelines that we shoot for K-2, I think that that's excellent. I think the fact that right now we're talking about maybe, you know, 20 some classes of 27 is, we don't like it. It's not where we want to be, but it's actually good considering where we are. And I'm probably broken record on this, but remind people that in 2001 to 2003, there were 29 kids in those elementary classes. So I think that it is the best of a bad situation. And I don't, you know, obviously there's things that probably each of us would rather not see cut or would like to, you know, see if we could avoid. But unless we're going to come up with some alternatives for where the money comes from, it's going to be hard. So, yeah, Mr. Brockman.
I'd like to go back to page 29. If you can help me understand something. Back to PD, professional development. So the way I understand the bullet points here is that in fiscal year 15, we spent, I want to focus on just two bullet points. The first one says it, last sentence, in FY15, this comprised $701,885 for salary, 5 days, right?
Yep.
And underneath that, one, two, three more down, is substitute teaching coverage for those days comprised $81,950.
Mm-hmm.
So if I do the quick math, that's about $782,000 that we paid for 5 days that the law does not require us to have, correct? The law requires 180 days. We have 185. We paid $782,000 or $156,000 a day for those 5 days. Is that
no,
right?
We actually have to provide professional development for our staff.
Do we have to do that with an extra day of school?
What you would be doing if you don't provide that is it would go back to student days, but it's not a budget cut.
The law requires 180 days, correct?
Students.
I think
for students.
Right.
But correct. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying we have 185-day school year. We choose to do that as a district. And there's more people than the school committee involved in that. But as a town, we chose to have 185-day school day.
I think it's a little bit more complicated than that, and I don't think at this point you want to. That's more of a collective bargaining issue.
I understand that. But everybody involved in the town of Reading made a series of choices.
The
185
does.
The 180
days.
The CBA may. There may be other reasons why we have to do it, and that I'm not saying we're not going to do it. But I just want to make clear that collectively, the 25,000 citizens of Reading decided to have a 185-day school year instead of 180 days, and the law of Massachusetts does not require that.
What, how are you saying that the 25,000 people? Are you saying that was the vote?
No. There's human beings in Reading.
Okay.
They got together. They formed different committees. They made decisions.
It's not this. The substitute teacher, that's a different category. That's not part of
the 5 days. But isn't that the cost? I'm sorry, I'm just trying to understand this. Isn't that the cost of providing, and this was a few years ago, and I know we've added coaches and we've changed it, but I want to understand.
The students don't come on those days.
Right.
There's no students
I think
on
if
those
we,
days.
I think the word days is confusing. I think
there.
If we eliminated that, for instance, we're not hiring substitutes on days when the students aren't here.
Okay.
That's for substitute coverage for other types of PD that could occur in incremental
okay,
times.
Okay, so they're not
the
paired
year.
Together. This is why I said help me understand that.
They're
I
not paired
with,
together.
Yeah. With the question,
yeah.
Help me understand. So you're doing that. Thank you. So the 701,000, that's salary for the 5 days.
Correct.
And that's 5 days over and above the 180 days that the law requires.
Does the law require PD?
The law requires that we need to provide professional development.
Okay, and does it say how much?
Really,
Mrs.
John.
We're
okay.
Really,
right.
We are, that's actually maybe
well,
not John.
I,
we're traipsing close outside of budget and into a different topic, so I think we need to rein this one in.
Okay. But 701,000, that's the cost of those 5 days. We can agree on that?
That is, yes.
That's
yeah.
My question. I'm not saying
that's,
anything
that is
about
correct.
CBA.
That is
I'm
correct.
Not getting involved in any of that. That's just, that's a choice we made.
Yes.
Thank you.
Dr. Knight.
So, John, would you just explain that the 81,950, how that, I think that would help, you know, how that's.
Yeah, I'll actually let Craig talk about that.
Well,
the substitute.
I give you what I think is my answer and make sure that, Gail, you tell me. I'm assuming that is when we're providing coverage for a teacher who is either for a part of a day or a full day getting training or things, that is when students are actually in session.
Could be a Dibbles day.
Right, right.
Yep.
Providing coverage.
Could be
for
a teacher's
teachers
going to a workshop for open session. Circle training, which
right.
Happens.
I thought that
right.
Would help.
Yeah.
So sometimes, for instance, we might get a sub for one day and that substitute might cover one teacher for a couple of hours and go to another teacher for a couple mm-hmm. Hours so that we kind of roll it that way.
Yeah. Would that also include if a teacher had implemented a workshop, just as an example, a workshop writing model in their classroom very successfully, bringing a different teacher in to say, here's how teacher,
that teacher
A
needed
absolutely.
Is implementing
hours,
this.
Yeah.
You're going to come in for an hour. You're going to watch this mm-hmm. Happen so you can bring it to your own classroom.
Absolutely.
So they haven't even left the building, but they need to leave their class.
Yes.
Anything else from the committee? Because I know there are people who have questions. I have one. On the impact of personnel reductions, on the elementary classroom teachers, increasing grade 3 to 5 classrooms, 25 to 27, how confident are you in that 27? Or are we really looking at 29?
No, I think it's 25.
You can
to
keep it
to
27.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, I have a question about 8th grade.
Eighth grade. Okay.
So foreign language will be now an elective.
Yes.
My children haven't quite made it to 8th grade. They're close. Can you explain what choice now an 8th grade will have to make that they didn't used to have to make? So how does this change the entering 8th grade experience?
I don't think we can answer that right now. That's part of what the two middle school principals are working on as part of this schedule.
Okay. Okay. I have another question. So, in thinking about the change to 6th grade,
mm-hmm.
We're losing a block of ELA, which is bad. But am I right that we're gaining a little bit more time in those 6 other blocks? So math will be a little bit more, science will be a little
yes.
Bit more. So there is a...
When you go into a 6th period day, you're gaining more instructional time in each of the classes.
So from an academic perspective, there's a definite loss, but there is something of a gain that offsets
yes.
It.
Yes.
Okay. I think that's it for
now.
Yep, go ahead, Mr. Roberts.
Just the part of Jean's question about the foreign language. You threw out a number a few minutes ago. You said you expected 200 students to sign. Where did that come from?
So the two middle schools will be sharing the foreign language teachers. So the foreign language teachers will travel between the two schools. So in the morning, they may be teaching at one school, and they'll teach 2 classes, and then they'll move to the other middle school in the afternoon and teach 2 classes. So when you look at the number of sections, and assuming 25 students in a classroom, which it could be a little bit more, you're talking approximately 200 students at the middle schools will be able to take a foreign language.
So that's my question. What if it's oversubscribed?
So that's another piece that the middle school principals are looking into right now, is what the selection process is going to look like.
Just one comment that you said that we're, the class sizes were greater in, you know, 2001, which is probably accurate, but the expectations of teachers and students now, as you know as well as I do, are greater, so.
Right.
Don't take that the wrong way. I just wanted to,
I
my wife would not appreciate if I went home and didn't address that.
And
not watching.
Right, and at that, a lot was different, because at that time, 75% of the children were in half-day kindergarten, so that meant 75% had parents at home, and it was a much different environment with parents coming in and volunteering, and so it was definitely very different in terms of being able to provide some support for that. And I don't want to see that again,
right,
sure.
Right. I knew that. I just wanted to.
Yeah.
Anything else from the committee? All right. I know there are some hands in the audience. Yes. Yes, I'm sorry. I should have done this at the beginning. I'm going to ask you to come up and speak into the microphone because we are being recorded. And if you could just say your name, that would be great.
All right. Well, for those of you who don't know me here, my name is Nathan Giacalone. And one of the questions I had, all this is, like, attending this meeting and seeing all the talk of the different cuts that we're going to make in various, like, key academic areas and potentially shifting more costs onto the seniors in such cases as the cap and gowns. One of the things that caught my eye in the budget was on page 64, figure 47. With the athletics, it shows a 25% increase in the budget, which looks like it's about $100,000 or so, and I'm not sure how we fit that into the budget and how we justify that when you're looking at all these massive, like, economic cuts that clearly no one supports. And I know that it's not a be-all, end-all, but perhaps that could be a way to kind of look to start, like, looking at different areas to cut instead of key areas like foreign language, or at the very least being able to possibly mitigate those cuts.
Could you repeat the figure and the number again that you were looking at?
Page 64, figure 47.
And you're looking at the athletics.
Yes, seeing the 25% increase.
I think I know the answer to this, but I think I'll send it over to Ms. Dowd to see. Then I'll see if I'm right.
The increase in athletics, we did, and actually it was in the highlights we did at the beginning, and we'll be talking about it Thursday. That is contractual increase for coaches, but the majority of it is related to increased ice time, the cost of ice, the cost of the bus transportations, and swimming. And we are looking at a proposed increase to the athletic fees to help offset some of that directly to that point, because we didn't want increases in athletics to be absorbed by other areas. So we have looked to increase the fees.
Yeah, the purpose of the increase
offset.
In the user fee is to make up for the increases.
And so I guessed wrong. I was also
and
wondering
the decrease in the offset. That's
that
the other reason.
That is what
yes.
I was thinking.
To
yes,
the
there's a decrease in
there
the offset.
A decrease
also.
Which
in
makes
the
a lot more sense.
Offset,
okay.
Which we're slightly offsetting with the increase in the fees, but in looking at the user activity account, we have to make sure the balances in there are sustainable, which is why we have to decrease the amount we're taking out of that.
And Nathan, you have hit on something that is a real challenge with our budget, something I'll give Ms. Dowd, she's brand new to her position, as feedback for the future, is this happens from time to time that in a year we take a big offset or a larger offset from the revolving account for a variety of reasons. It could be just a variety of reasons. But the problem is then the next year when you reduce the offset, it looks like this huge jump in expenses when it really isn't. It's just that you're not putting revenue in. But it makes it very difficult to read the budget, so you're actually right to point that out as challenging from an understanding standpoint. But that is not, there is not an actual 25% increase in athletic costs.
Okay.
There's just some revenue we used last year that we don't have access to this year.
But, Jean.
Yeah, Mrs.
Zabrowski. I also think it's sort of contextually, it's not like we protected, said we're not going to make any athletic cuts and we're going to make all these cuts in other areas. We looked at it and said in order to be able to maintain the athletic programs that we have with some of these costs, but to maintain what we have and not be in a position of saying we're going to cut all freshman sports or something, we have to increase the fees, because we did not want the academic, let's say the academic areas of the budget, to basically fund or, you know, enable athletics to not have a cut. So I want to make sure that, like, you realize that also. So it's the only reason there's no cuts to the athletic, to different athletic sports right now, is because we're looking at a proposed fee increase, and that will be enabled to maintain it. If we don't decide on that fee increase or something, then we're going to have to go back.
We would have to make,
figure
right,
this out.
Right.
Yeah.
So instead of saying cutting back some of these sports programs, instead we're looking to cut some of these, like, academic programs, because I'm not sure how to, like, if that's showing up right here in this budget figure, because I think you had you were kind of right in explaining how, because now I understand how there more, a lot of that is more from the fee increases and things like that nature, like with the swimming rinks and the bus transportations, but I'm still not. So does that mean that it's trying to maintain the current, like, sports activities versus potentially trying to cut them as part of all the other program cuts that are going on?
Dr. Doherty.
So athletics actually, in its own way, takes a cut every year because we charge a user fee. If we didn't charge a user fee, we'd have to either cut from athletics or cut from somewhere else. So the purpose of the user fee is so that we don't cut athletics, because essentially charging a user fee is the equivalent of a cut. It's meant to maintain that program. That's the first piece. The second piece is, and we looked at this exhaustively, we're gonna save this till Thursday, but we can say it now. If you make a cut in athletics, let's say we wanna cut a level of sports, freshmen, you actually have to then make another cut, because you're not only cutting the sports, but you're cutting the user fee revenue from all of the freshmen, say it was freshmen, that took that sport. So then you have to make an additional cut. So it's not as easy as just cutting that. We also looked at cutting down on the season for the different levels, making sure that we stayed within Title IX requirements. That cut didn't yield us much savings at all. So we did look at different options, and the user fee increase allows the expenses to be absorbed through the increase in the user fee without affecting the rest of the budget.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's pretty much all I had to ask about that.
Thank you very much for coming out tonight. Dr. Nye?
What some districts do, and I'm not recommending it, I don't think it's good because it decreases the amount of students that actually participate in sports, is their sport is fully funded by user fees. I've seen programs completely lose student interest in some of the peripheral sport, not peripheral, but let's say high school wrestling, let's say, or swimming, because they're going to be paying for that pool time and then wrestling, you know, two coaches, and, you know, so that it doesn't work out that well. But I can understand what you're saying. I think what you're also saying is, how much is actually budgeted through taxation in our athletic program? Do you follow me?
Yeah, I do. We can get you the exact percentage.
We're going to talk about it
Thursday.
Yeah,
that's a great follow up for Thursday. Mm-hmm. Really good.
Thank you.
Good,
yes.
Question.
How much does the user fee pay for the
thank
expenses,
you for waiting.
Essentially, is what we're.
My name is Carl Anderson, for those who don't know me. I have a couple of questions. First one, has anybody from the superintendent's office or anybody from the school committee talked to the finance committee? I know the town of Reading hired someone to deal with economic development. That's someone's salary who's brand new. I know in addition, there used to be a senior group, I believe it's a senior group, that was located in town hall. They were moved out and they're now on Haven Street paying about $2,000 in rent a month. So there's all this waste in the town's budget that could be going to our schools. So have, like, those positions could be cut. Has the school committee talked about that?
So
I'd rather see
because we have a few people in the room who are highly qualified to answer that question.
Yeah,
I actually want to answer your question globally before, and I have a couple people who might want to weigh in. There is a really high level of collaboration between the municipal side of our government and the school side of our government. Throughout the year, off the top of my head, in January, November, we meet as called a financial forum. So the finance committee, the board of selectmen, and the school committee, and the library board of trustees all get together. RCTV tapes it. The public is invited, and we go through exactly what you're talking about. What's, you know, we say what's going on the school side. What challenges are we facing? What are our initiatives for the future? And they tell us public safety, library, and all of that. So we work very, very closely together. And in fact, throughout the year, have regular opportunities to sit down together and have those conversations. So it's a high level of collaboration, and that's not just this. That's going back. I've been involved for 7 or 8 years. That's going back, and it predates me. So for a very long time, that's been the case. Mr. Berman, from our Board of Selectmen, did you want to?
I just really quickly, if you really want to see what we do on the town side, I invite you to come Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, homework permitted, and just see how we grill department heads about how to squeeze $1.05 out of every dollar. So I can trust you. You can trust me that there is absolutely no waste going on the town side. We have people. We have two people doing three jobs now. So we've gone through these series of cuts, and actually, Reading is one of the few towns that actually works together with the towns and schools. Where we basically say, what are the costs of really operating the town, and split those right off the top, and then split 1/3, 2/3 town and schools. So there is a lot of collaboration, and the same level of drilling down and discourse is going on the town side as it is here on the school.
I know one of the town meeting members for Precinct 7, I was talking to her tonight, actually. I forget the committee that she was talking about, but it used to be a volunteer committee that the town of Reading got rid of and is now paying someone to run. I don't know what that is, so I'll find that out and I'll bring that as a question.
Yeah, you can bring that on Tuesday. What you're referring to is the Economic Development Committee. The Board of Selectmen decided to sunset that committee because its function was really, we needed to actually go beyond the function that they were doing. And we now hired an economic development planner, director. We're looking to develop the remaining parcels in Reading so that we can actually increase the pie. So instead of the schools and the towns fighting about how much money we're going to get and squeezing all these nickels, we can actually grow the pie so that there's actually more money to distribute. But that will be discussed Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. So I invite you to tune in or come down.
Absolutely.
I think that the 2/3, 1/3 split, I'm glad that you brought that up. That's a mechanism. It's not a policy. It's not a law. It's not a regulation. It is an agreement, a way we do business.
Collegial.
And it serves to promote a lot of collaboration. So like Mr. Berman just said, you take those accommodated costs, the health insurance, the special education out of district, some very volatile things off the top, and then whatever's left, 2/3 goes to the school, 1/3 goes to the town. That means when we're in hard times, as we are clearly right now, we suffer proportionally. And if there's this happy increase of revenues, we benefit proportionally. It avoids conversations where people are arguing about what's more important, protecting something on the school side or something on the library. It really does keep the town working together and not at odds. And before I get your next question, Mark Doxer, who is the chair of our town's finance committee, is here.
I'm here with Paul Perry, who's also a member of the finance committee. We work very closely with all of the different groups in the town. We actually represent the town meeting. Bring to the at the end of the day, the final budget for them to review and approve. We go through with these different committees. We have different meetings. We have a financial forum that's been brought up a few times, actually multiple forums, which is a chance for all different groups to bring their input on what's happening, what are their priorities. One of the things we do is we look at potential new revenue sources, potential things that seem to be wasteful. They're open forums. We invite community input. We'd love to have more and more people come to that. It would be great. What we also do is in March, after having kind of heard all the presentations, the school committee goes through and has an approved budget for them, or a recommended budget. The selectmen do the same thing for the town. That then comes into the finance committee, and you're invited every Wednesday in March, 7:30, town hall. We go through pretty in-depth analysis of what's going on, making sure we understand what's there. Working, as Mr. Berman said, to make sure that, you know, we understand what's happening. We think the town, I'll speak for myself, that the town's very well run, very well managed, that there aren't any big opportunities out there that we haven't grabbed at, either for more revenue or for less expense. So we work toward that, we invite the community input whenever, and please come join us, great.
I guess one of my next questions, I know earlier you guys talked about how in addition to the foreign language being cut for middle schools, the middle school math team is going to be added just to the regular group teams. So I know in middle school, when I was in middle school, there were three different levels of math I could have taken. I could have been in a lower level math, the equivalent of a college prep, the equivalent of an SEP, or the equivalent of like an honors class. There was an accelerated program. What's going to happen to the kids that want a more accelerated program for math? How are they going to be able to be almost in an accelerated program with only one math teacher? How's that going to work?
So you're right. I mean, we are still looking at the levels and how many that we want to have, but absolutely the accelerated pathway that you're talking about will absolutely be sustained. We've seen that growing over the last couple of years. And just last week with the sequences we talked about, we're actually going to be opening up more sequences through the high school level to ensure that students who have completed, or even if they have not completed Algebra 1 in 8th grade, that they still have a straight path through 12th grade if they want to access AP Calculus or whatever. So, and we think that's becoming more and more possible because kids are getting a stronger foundation because of the work that we're doing aligning to the standards at the elementary through 6th grade.
Absolutely. Then my one of my last questions regarding foreign language. I know I'm a sophomore in college now, and I think that the Reading Public School System really prepared me for college. And I think I'm doing very well in my classes, and I'm very grateful to Reading Public Schools. But I know in college it's a requirement to take a foreign language. And I just wanted to make the point that the kids I'm friends with and the kids that I go to school with, the kids that come from out of state that never had access to a language in middle school or never had access to a language in even a high school setting, maybe they didn't have 2 years, the kids especially that didn't have it in middle school or elementary school don't perform nearly as well as the kids who did. So I know having taken a language in middle school as a requirement, I'm better prepared for my college classes than the kids that did not. So I do think that if there's a chance to say a foreign language, it's a chance worth taking, especially in a world where you're gonna be involved with other countries. Global economics and all of that. So I do think foreign language is pretty important and shouldn't be cut if there's a way to prevent that. And then the last point that I know Mr. Nyan brought up earlier, that I know everybody in my neighborhood was pretty angry about related to the budget. It does seem, and I know Dr. Doherty's doing a very good job, nothing against the superintendent's office, but it does seem that the majority of the impact is on the students, because it seems like about 13 teachers are being cut and losing their jobs, but at the same time, there's going to be no administrators being laid off. That's just a point to leave you guys with. So I do think that parents will be pretty angry to hear that. And that's all.
Thank you. Yes.
I'm Joanne Alvarez, and I head up the foreign language department here at the high school. I first would like to thank all of the school committee members for speaking up for foreign language, because each and every one of you, you've all said things that were on my list of things to say or questions. I'd also thank our students that came, our graduates, that was wonderful, and about a half a dozen of my colleagues from the high school and the middle school of foreign language teachers. question first for Dr. Nyan. You mentioned the idea of a semester idea and possible. Could we ever do something like that? Were you referring to the type of things that some towns have where you'll test out a different language in each part of the grade and try something like that?
The school district that I'm familiar with,
trimester,
Ambus, did do something of that nature. I can't recall exactly, but there was an I mean, it's probably comparable to what we do here, exploratory, but even in greater detail. And, you know, they did have opportunities to try different foreign languages, if I recall correctly. put this on Carolyn Walsh, who lives in Danvers now, to check on that. But I think that's correct.
There was actually a time in sixth grade that we had that.
That's what I mentioned, yeah.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Thought it for a bit.
I think that's where it happens, actually.
Question for Dr. Dougherty. Do you know if, when the eighth graders start the elective foreign language, will they have foreign language every day?
Yes.
And if they don't choose foreign language as an elective, do you know what else they
might
choose?
That's what we're still working
on. Okay.
That's what the restructuring of the other special, I believe Ms. Borowski asked the same question.
Yeah, but I didn't know if it was, I thought it was a different
Yeah,
question.
That's what the two middle school principals are still working on the particulars. Okay. It will be using existing staffing positions and perhaps restructuring those staffing positions.
Right.
So that's.
Okay, so right now we have seven foreign language teachers at the middle schools and there will be only two. Could you speak to the impact of the cuts, not only on the middle schools, but the ripple effect on the high school, possible?
I'll be more than happy to. I don't know if it's appropriate, though, considering there's a lot of different staffing cuts that are going to have ripple effects.
Mm-hmm. But when
so
we say
I'm going to the chair now.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if that's an appropriate conversation.
You can continue.
Well,
because it is, there's a lot of seniority issues that are in the contract.
Okay.
That would affect movement.
Okay.
And they're each subject has its own seniority.
Is that
the way it's
broken
down?
Did you mean seniority ripples or curriculum issues or
seniority ripples right now.
She's referring to seniority.
If it's inappropriate, that's fine. I just wanted to know if the public were aware.
Yeah.
Because in those numbers, you say so many cuts at the high school, but those cuts do not include what may happen that will ripple
out. But there aren't going to be any cuts in foreign language at the high school.
I know.
Okay.
In
so that's what we're reporting out.
Official cuts, no.
I'll speak globally.
Yeah.
That because of
and
all of the teacher
global.
Reductions that we're going to have, unfortunately, there will be some bumping occurring between levels.
Okay.
If there is if there are PTS teachers involved in bumping, and this is beyond foreign language, this is happening unfortunately in other subjects as well, that they could be bumping other levels, whether it be elementary or high school, if they have the appropriate certification.
That strikes me as outside the purview of the school committee.
Correct.
That sounds
I don't
more
think
administrative.
We're there yet,
no.
We're not there yet, but it is an administrative question
Correct.
Versus a policy
Correct.
Question.
But there are no cuts in foreign language at the high school.
Ms. Borowski.
Yeah. Dr. Dougherty just said it at the very end there that it's qualified, just so that people know, if people are watching this, the very end of your statement was that ripple effect occurs, but the teachers have to be qualified to teach whatever they
Correct. They have to be fully licensed for that.
And qualified for those levels and that
right.
subject. And, yeah, right. So it's not. Unqualified teachers.
Yes.
Yes.
Again, thank you for asking so many of my questions already, and we'll see you another time.
Thank you for coming out tonight and for sharing your input. Yes.
Hi, so my name is Jessica Squires, and I'm a senior at the high school currently. So what I think myself and a lot of other students were wondering is why, like, specific reasons why it's the foreign language department that's getting all of the cuts. I feel like we hear, as much as you try to keep things, like, you know, for the meetings, we hear a lot of this stuff before it happens and word on the street spreads. So today and over the past few days, just a lot of kids in the high school have been considering, why is it the foreign language? Like, is it enrollment? Is it college applications, like what the college requirements are? Is it standardized testing? Like, what are the main driving factors that made you choose foreign language as the program to take the majority of the cuts, especially in middle school?
Sure. I'm going to ask Dr. Dougherty to answer that, but I do want to make it clear that no budget is final. This is the beginning of the discussion, not the end of it. So I just want that to be clear.
And none of us chose those. Not to say that we might not have, but we didn't, it was the superintendent budget.
Were you here for the beginning of the presentation?
Yes.
Okay. So we have been wrestling internally with this since October 19th.
Mm-hmm.
And we've gone through at least 10 drafts
mm-hmm.
of what is being presented tonight. As I mentioned earlier, we are advocating for none of them. We had everything that we've chosen is bad.
Yeah.
We had to choose what we felt was the least impactful of the bad. And everyone can have a different opinion on that. Some things is going to result in higher class sizes. Other things are going to result in a reduced access at that particular time to a program, meaning foreign language. Students are still going to get foreign language in eighth grade. Students are still going to have the opportunity to take AP at the end of their high school career. Those were things that we had long discussions about. So there are certainly cuts to foreign language, and but we also have cuts to English. We have cuts to the exploratory areas. We have cuts to a lot of places. Bottom line is we had to cut $1.4 million, and that's not something you can do easily. And we've been making cuts now since 4 or 5 years ago. So we've tried to stay away from these cuts, and we had no choice at this point. And we've also stayed away from the middle school for several years because we knew that if we had to cut at the middle school, we were going to have to cut a lot at the middle school at one time to try to maintain that model moving forward. So
I guess what I'm saying is, like, I totally understand that you don't want to do any of this. Like, this whole situation's making you have to do things you would never want to do. It's
right.
Making you guys look like the villains in some people's perspectives when, in reality, you really just have a certain amount of money to work with and something's going to get cut. So I'm not trying to accuse you of anything. I think you're doing a really great job handling it, and I'm glad that foreign language has definitely stayed in the mix for the middle school. Hearing that it could have been cut even more, that's like terrifying to me as someone who wants to major in international relations and someone who really cares about that.
Right.
But why, so just looking at the board, like, why was it foreign language? Like, I'm not saying there's a better choice.
Ms. Borowski.
Yeah, Ms. Tom. I just, and maybe there's another perspective, but I think when you look at it too, you look at, you know, what will students, we have to make cuts, but what will students have an opportunity to still be able to have access to as we progress? And maybe a year from now or 2 years from now, we get an override and we can refund the schools. And so from that perspective, that's why there was some emphasis on trying to make sure that we don't have the juniors and seniors lose access to some of the things that they need to complete their career, because that is their very last chance. So when you look at this, even if the recommendation had been to completely cut the foreign language, there still would be the opportunity for students to at least get 4 years of a foreign language in high school. So this is certainly a little bit a better opportunity than that opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that I looked at it and said, we have to make cuts in places where there still might be an opportunity for a student to make that up. Granted, you're not going to do third grade again, so you're going to get what you get. And then, you know, maybe in fourth grade or fifth grade or sixth grade, and that's what happened in the last override. When students went through those grades and there were too many kids in the class and there weren't enough resources to support the teachers, and it took time sometimes for kids to make that up. And it got made up in middle school and with teachers that worked extra hard and maybe with, you know, parents and students at home. But it didn't always all get made up. And, you know, that's the bad part. But I think in this case, I look at it and I say, you know, we're still going to be able to give students the opportunity. And I, for all the reasons you said and the reasons cited about this is an international, a global community, having a language is an important part of a school career, just because we have to recognize we are on a global planet, not where it's not just the United States.
And I just want to reiterate what I think we've all said is nobody wants to do this at all. Yeah, and I appreciate that you do. I really do. The only other thing I would add is that an awful lot that we do is mandated by state regulation. So there's a whole bunch of stuff that we can't touch. So that's a limiting factor as well.
I just want to say that I'm extremely impressed and proud of the fact that we have three Reading High students or graduates come here and advocate for something that they feel strongly about. And I just want to tell you to continue to do that the rest of your life. It's very important. If you believe in something, you need to really move forward. So congratulations for you three coming in.
I would agree, and not only advocate, but advocate in an articulate and evidence-based way.
Exactly.
You really added a lot
you
to
did,
this conversation.
You did a really good job.
It's true. Oh, yes.
Yeah, I just want to, for all three of you, thank you for doing that. And just to Dr. Nyan's earlier point at the start, we're at the first stage of a multi-meeting process. There's like five more meetings. So anybody, you know, that wants to participate in the process, please. I know it's hard to sit in front of all the microphones and everything, but we really appreciate hearing from each of you. Everyone was very articulate, very well thought out in what they bring to us. We have the opportunity to ask additional questions, which you'll see in writing. So that's helpful for us to formulate our questions. So you're making an impact on our thinking. That's very valuable. Thank you.
The budget is online now on the website.
Tomorrow morning, everything that you see tonight, including the budget book, will be on our website.
So that's really important because this is an incredibly valuable document with a lot of information, and it's the information that we're going to be using over the next couple of weeks. And so it'd be really important to, if you continue or you're talking to people who are concerned about what's going on, you know, send the link around to this document once it's up on the school committee page.
Okay. And you will post your PowerPoint as well.
Yes, everything will be. Yeah.
Okay.
Do you have anything else?
No, that's really it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions over here?
Great. Yeah, Ms. Van.
Hi, Eileen Manning. I had a clarifying question on the question that Ms. Webb had asked on the Joshua Eaton funding.
Yes.
And you had mentioned that it was all special ed.
The additions that we've made this year, so we've had a special ed teacher and the team chair we made full time. Those are the two major pieces that are in this budget.
Okay, because there's also the after school program piece, which I assume is not special ed.
That is correct, I'm sorry, and that is that is currently in the operating budget, right, yes.
Is that in the budget for next year? Or is that a short-term plan?
That right now is a short term, and we can certainly revisit it, but right now it's short term.
Okay, so it's not considered for next year. Okay.
I have a follow-up on that. There is also an additional reading tutor at Josh Wheaton, so the reading specialist could perform some of the jobs.
That's short term also for this year.
But is that reading tutor only special education students, or
no,
broader?
No,
I thought it was as
no.
well, so that's another one that's
no.
broader.
No.
Just, thank you. Go ahead, Ms.
Okay, thanks. Additionally, I appreciate the work to find the least worst option, and this is not anything that we wanted to do, and it's ugly. And recognizing that you don't necessarily want to go into the detail of all 10 different iterations that you had considered, can you give us a little information about perhaps what the second least worst plan was?
I really can't, because it would involve talking about other potential cuts, personnel cuts.
That could create a pretty significant staff morale problem.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Hi, Sherry Vandenacker. I'm sorry to keep you. I just got this tonight, like, you know, everybody, obviously. So I'm trying to match up page 36 and page 54. And I just had a couple of questions about some of the cost center. So,
page 36 or?
Yeah, page 36 and page 54. I'm trying to look at the figures. So these should be fast questions, actually.
36 and 54?
Yes. So the regular day budget. Okay, so I'm noticing on page 54, you have substitutes in two line items. You have them for 203,675 dollars, or no, that's stipends, I'm sorry, $102,400. And then several lines down, you have substitutes again at $285,120. So I was wondering why there are those, why it's separated, so what the figure is, and also why there's a 23% or 24% proposed increase in one of those.
So under professional salaries, and Gail is going to correct me on any of this, under professional salaries, that is substitutes which are for long term.
Okay.
So if a teacher is out on maternity leave or because they're replacing a teacher.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why it's under professional salaries. The other...
The other one's right above contract services.
And we, when we were looking through, the reason that there is the increase is it's comparing the increase to what was currently budgeted in the current year, but if we look back at, we also did sort of
a
zero-based bottoms up. We looked at what historically we have been doing so that we're not constantly saying, well, we'll have to move money from here, hope we have it. We looked to actually fund what we have historically been. So that's why if you actually compare that to where we have been in the past 2 to 3 years, it's in line with what we actually have been spending as opposed to just looking at what last year's budgeted number. We felt it was a better approach to actually budget where the money is being incurred on an annual basis to start to make the comparisons look
more reasonable.
So
and those are daily subs.
Yeah.
Also include the paraeducator piece. That, so when a paraeducator fills in for as a substitute, they get a contractual increase above their salary, so that's reflected in there as well.
Yeah, okay, that was my next question, because on page 36, the para line is 477K, about. Is that right? It's in, it's the 1, 2, 3, 4, the fourth item down on page 36. It's 400. No, I'm sorry, where is this?
It's under administration and services.
That's their salary.
The 477.
Yeah, that's the salaries of all the paraprofessionals.
And then on page 54.
For regular day, I believe.
The para figure right above the substitutes is 751,000. So I just wondered why there was such a discrepancy.
So this is two different charts.
Yeah, exactly.
Which are not going to align directly.
Sure.
Because some are. So that's why you see the discrepancies in what we're talking about.
Oh, but it's like a $300,000 discrepancy. So that's why I was curious. Because, like, see on page 36, paraprofessionals are $477,000.
Right, but that's what it costs for regular ed paraprofessionals.
Regular ed, right. And then on the regular day budget para line on page 54. You see it's 751,000.
It's a different category. If you break down paraprofessionals, and Gail will be able to give you that answer next time.
Okay, that would be great.
But it's like everything else that we've been showing you, is that you drill down and there are more line items that break it down.
It's a really good question, though. Can we get an answer to that on?
Yeah, we will. Yeah,
whatever the next one Thursday.
Right.
Thank you, Ms. Bennett.
Carl Anderson again. Just a quick question that I thought of. I know it was mentioned with hockey, like the increased ice time, the increased ice cost, and with swimming, for example, the increased pool cost. Has the school committee, like has the town of Reading, or are you able to look to going to another area to use an ice rink or another area to use a pool? Because I know in Wilmington, I always go skating there at their ice rink because it's much cheaper for me to go to the free skate than at Burbank. I'm assuming you guys have looked into using other ice rinks, but would that even be an option?
I think it's a question to ask Mr. Zayer on Thursday.
Yeah, it's a good one. When we get into that cost center, it's a great question.
Yeah, all right, thank you.
Hi there, Alicia Williams. This might be a loaded question, and you might all hate me for asking, but I'm a little confused by transportation. I keep seeing it pop up all over the place, and I know that there's different places, but you were talking about the athletics and people were concerned about the 25% increase, and there's a transportation cost center in that 25% increase, correct? You had said that?
There's athletic transportation, there's regular day mandatory transportation.
Correct.
There's the METCO transportation, which is funded under the grant.
Okay.
Special education transportation would be under special education.
Okay.
And that's under a different contract.
Right. So I guess my question is, I just keep seeing it pop up in all these different line items, and I'm just.
That happens with a lot of our
okay.
things. So if, for instance, if you wanted to see professional development, you're going to see it under regular day, you're going to see it under special education.
Okay.
So
right.
that is fairly typical.
Okay.
You have to capture the cost under the correct cost center and for reporting purposes down the road for the Department of Elementary Secondary Education,
you have to
categorized in the right place.
Okay.
So athletic transportation is under athletics.
Okay.
Which is in the district-wide cost center.
Okay.
Regular day transportation is under regular day.
Okay.
And that's very much driven by the State Department's reporting requirements. Our budget is kind of
correct.
Built around their model.
Correct.
That's how they come up with the per pupil number
correct.
Eventually.
Okay. Do we have a place, and forgive me if it's in here, that what we spend on a whole on transportation, what that number is? Did I miss
it? You're talking about regular day?
Just
all
transportation.
I mean, we can certainly.
Okay. Thank you.
It's actually lower than a lot of school districts. We don't have a lot of bus transportation in Reading.
Yes, Mr. Bob.
Point of privilege. On reflection, I want to apologize to the chair and to Dr. Daugherty. I think in one of my previous comments, I talked over someone and I interrupted the chair, and I think decorum is really important. I apologize for doing that, so I can do better.
Chair forgives you without
Thank
bias.
You.
Thank you.
We have to go into executive session. For those of you who are here tonight, thank you. It really is true. The level of discussion was great. I saw Ms. Dowd taking down notes. I've taken down notes. You have informed me. So thank you for being here and participating. Unless anyone has anything else, we are going to move to executive session. We have a motion.
Move to return to executive session for the approval of the minutes and not to return. To open.
Second.
Dr. Ryan? Mr. Robin?
Yes.
Yes.
Mr.
Robinson?
Yes.
Mrs. Webb.
A little excited.
Yes.
Thank you. We're in executive session.